Prikota Sita. Now, the Lord touches us with His glory so that we can understand how wonderful it is to walk in it. And then, you know, it's an invitation. It's actually an invitation to come and abide. It's actually an invitation to come live in this place. Amen. It's a living invitation card. So every time anyone experiences the manifest presence of the Lord, all that's happening is they're being called by the Lord saying, come on into this place. Doesn't it feel good? Isn't it wonderful? Would you like to live here all the time? So if you can understand that, if you can recognize that, then you can respond and say yes. And then He will respond with His manifest presence all the time. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. And if you slip out into whatever realm, I'm talking about the manifest presence. There's no escaping His presence. I mean, you know, no matter if you made your bed in hell, you could escape His presence. But there's a manifest presence. Manifest presence that brings an overwhelming flow of His glory, His love, His joy, His peace, His goodness. Hallelujah. His confidence, His boldness, His faith. Hallelujah. I've discovered that it's very easy to get quickly back in manifest presence of the Lord. Just repent for a bad attitude, because that's usually one of the things that would cause us to not be in cooperation with what God's doing, which then as a result, because you're not in cooperation with what God is doing, you don't sense the manifest presence. And, you know, the Lord just really responds quickly to that, or just simply just a giving of thanks. Because maybe it's not a bad attitude. Maybe just overwhelmed with circumstance and situation, a bunch of things coming at you right, left, and center, and you're just kind of overwhelmed by it. Well, just begin to give thanks. Anybody still not in the manifest presence? Because the next thing I would say is just start giving thanks unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If your heart does not feel what your lips have uttered, because God's not real to you. And Father doesn't want folks with their to draw near to Him with their lips and their hearts far from Him. And the one who's commanded is the one who supplies. Sometimes people think about these things and they begin to look to themselves. It'd be like looking to yourself to raise someone from the dead, or looking to yourself to walk upon the water, or looking to yourself to save yourself. You just turn to the Lord and you say, Lord, these are the things that I want from You. Hallelujah. I'm going to give You this list, Lord, what I want from You. I want You, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost. And I want an ever-increasing display of who You are in my life. How you like that? Now, out of that, God will make you worth something. And useful for something. People just get obligated. People get obligated. They think they got to go run around and do things for God. Father's not interested in you running around being a false witness. He's not interested in us running around bearing false witness because we're doing it in our own human ability. Get yourself some power first. Get yourself some relationship. Get yourself some reality of God in your life first. Huh? Amen. Father wants to establish us in those things that last forever. Pretty soon we won't have anybody to minute. We won't have anybody to witness to, but we'll have we'll have the privilege of interacting with Him. Hallelujah. Papa will do more with your life in one day, more in your life in one day, than you could do with your life in 1,000 lifetimes. Do more in your life in one day. All you gotta do is say, you know what? I'm not gonna do this without You, Lord. I'm not going to do this because I got to feel better about myself. Somebody asked me so long ago, and they said, how is it that you can do something that you're not good at and be so happy? And they were referring to golf. And I said, because it doesn't mean anything to me. It means absolutely nothing. I have no identity wrapped up in it. It means nothing to me. I'm not trying to prove nothing to myself or anybody else. And we want We want that to be the way it is for you in your life. That's the way it's supposed to be for us in every dimension of our life. The only thing that is valuable to us, the only thing that's meaningful to us, is this life and identity and purpose that we have in God, because that's the only thing that's real. Did you know that? How many of you knew that? I mean, for realies kind of thing. For real. I mean, did you really, really know that? Really, just it's all the rest of it. Just, I mean, at best, it's occupy till he comes, and that's doing something really responsible with your time. At best, it surely isn't the value of your life or the meaning of your life. You can't stand before the Lord and say, Lord, I played golf really good. What's wrong? You know, or Lord, I did so many things for you. What's wrong? I believe that one of the most important things to Father is that every ulterior motive in our life, everything that justifies us outside of Jesus Christ needs to be removed from our lives. Everything that gives us confidence outside of Jesus, outside of what he's done for us, outside of his goodness, outside of his grace, outside of his provision, doesn't have any impact on us anymore, doesn't have any value. And that's a process. And the more that people have come to rely upon themselves and trust in themselves and think, you know, be so blessed with themselves. Are you listening to me? Blessed are they who make more than $1 million a year. Blessed are they who've done really well in school. Blessed are they who have a high opinion of themselves. That just doesn't exist. It's actually the opposite. Blessed are the poor. Blessed are they who mourn. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness. There's something I want, and I pray that you'll want it too, more than anything else, is to continually understand and know a realm of living with God where you're baptized in the fire of his presence, where his presence is like a fire. Now listen, I'm telling you, it's not imaginary. I know how imaginary we make things. So it's not imaginary. It's not kind of sort of that way. It's not a simile. It's not an allegory. It's really, his presence is like a fire. His presence is like a rain. So I said, don't tell people that, then they're going to question their salvation. That doesn't make any sense to me at all. Don't cause people to really believe that they're going to get healed because they may get disappointed and question their salvation. That is absolutely senseless and stupid. That is actually an antichrist doctrine so far as I'm concerned. Because Father has purposed that we hunger and thirst for these things, that we believe him, that we trust him, that we throw everything in on what he said. And tonight, the Lord's going to release me to minister on just something so wonderful about how he's devoted to taking care of us and answering everything that we ask him to do. Asking, the humility of asking. But if you're not willing to pursue what you ask for, your asking isn't really meaningful. And if you're not willing to not only ask and pursue what you're asking for with perseverance until you have it, then it's still an incomplete statement and desire of the heart. And that's why it says, ask, seek, and knock. And I'm just going to talk to you about these things that I believe God just give us wisdom and understanding to lay hold on this wonderful realm of his life. This wonderful realm of his divine provision. God is so good. You know, you can say to me, oh, Pastor, I've been asking the Lord, oh God. Oh, give me revelation concerning your word. And you know what I tell you? Are you reading the Bible? Because if you're not, there's no seeking, there's no pursuing. Do you understand it? To make it simple? There's nothing that changes here. And then you know, it's so big. The power, the thing is, so the Bible's so big, so many scriptures, so many verses, so many ideas, you know. Oh God, how am I ever going to get a hold of this? Read again. Ask Him while you're reading. Apply these things. When you hear, read something in the Word of God, and the Lord causes it to stand out big to you, that's Him talking to you. You know all you got to do then? You know what you got to do then? When it stands out to you, is say, Father, I want this. And you know, we want it on such a way that we begin to bang on the door. Luke 11:8, till somebody gets up out of bed. And He will not rise and give to him. I tell you, He will not rise and give to him just because He's a friend, but because He's not going to stink and go away until He gets what He wants. Hallelujah. And the Lord emphasized it again in Luke chapter 18. He emphasized it again. Look at the widow. Constantly coming, constantly coming, constantly coming, constantly coming, constantly coming. So, what are you believing God for? Is it divine health? Well, then quit eating pork chops and bacon and drinking a gallon of milk for breakfast. Huh? Gallon and a half ice cream for dessert at lunchtime. Garbage food. White bread by the loaf. Because you're not getting nothing. You say you will believe in divine health all you want. You listening to me? I'm talking about spiritual applications, asking, seeking, knocking. There is a discipline. There is a discipline. You know, and it gets really hard. I told Ann today that, you know, or a couple of days ago, I'm not eating anything till but salads until I can't pinch this inch that I have developed. And then we're thinking, how about somebody who can pinch 6 inches? You what's happened? You let yourself go so far. Now the discipline to get back. Whew. Well, you better do it. Because same thing in the spirit. Same thing in the spirit. Same thing spiritually. The habits, the things that we get into. I mean, if you've been doing something, let's say you've been doing something for 6-7 years. Let's say you've been leaving your closet messy for 6-7 years. It's used to it. It's hard to get out of it. Huh? It's hard to get out of it. Let's just say you commonly drive your car and the floorboard is piled with stuff, and you're used to having your feet in that mess. You're used to it. Somebody else gets in your car and goes, am I allowed to put my feet down? it's hard to change those habits. And you can ask the Lord, and you can say, Lord, please help me, change me. Lord, please, I want to lay hold on divine health. Because people want you to come to the hospital and pray for them when they've made a life of sickness and disease. They've not made a life of divine health. Now, I'm just talking to you about divine health because I want to talk to you about divine gifts tonight as well. I want to talk to you about everything Father wants you and I to have as His witnesses, as His representatives on the earth. People just want to make believe that anything, you know, they can just, you can just have it whatever you feel, whatever, you know. My grandfather was depressed, and my dad was depressed, and so I'm depressed too, and so it's okay. It's not okay. So what we want you to be able to do is we want you to be able to see very clearly the things that you have need of, and then understand in a very practical way how to lay hold on them, how to do them, how to have them. Because it's just as real as any. I think that the application of divine health is an excellent example. It's just that real. You can pray for divine health all you want, but you better start eating right, and you better get yourself an exercise program. I was so proud of Tim Hall because the last time he was here, about a year ago, I said, okay, here's, I know you got this problem, that problem, the other problem. Okay, in Jesus' name, no problem. Now, here's your exercise ropes. And here are your little exercise things, gizmos. Now, you lay hold on divine help for yourself, because you've got an anointing and a gift. So people touch that realm of the anointing and that gift, they get healed. But you're going to get healed. You're going to have divine help. And so he came back this year, and he pulls out of his suitcase his traveling pack of exercise gizmos that we gave him. And he lost weight, and his knees were doing stronger, doing better. And he's laying hold upon something in God. He's not only asked, he's pursuing. Huh? He's pursuing. And he's pursuing by understanding the things that he's got to do and applying them. And then he's being relentless by not giving up just because it didn't happen. I can be, for me, I can get my physical health back in less than 30 days. Okay, I can be a 7-day wonder. I know how to do it. Ann and I were out running today, running, eating salads, no bread, no. You had bread, but you can handle it. No bread. I mean, we know what we're going to do. Well, that's great. You say, well, that's no fear, man. It would take me 2 years to get back in shape. Well, you didn't catch yourself soon enough. You're not applying. I'm applied to divine help. I'm applied to divine health in every area of my life. And this is what I want you to get. I want you to get this. I'm applied to the giftings of the Spirit in every area of my life. I'm applied. You're going to have to be applied. It is not going to happen by itself. The only thing that happens by itself is weeds. That's the way it works. Everything else, you're going to have to go after it. And so those of you, it's going to take you a year or 2 years or 3 years to get your physical health back. You better get after it. Huh? You better get yourself somebody who knows what kind of diet you should be eating. Amen. I have a friend of mine who's weighed 320 pounds. I'm like looking at him going, dude. He gave himself total application, just gave himself. It was today about 190, 200 pounds. Just relentlessly gave himself. I know another guy. You know, he was almost the same weight, and he just gave himself. Well, also what I see in their lives is that they're giving themselves to spiritual things, not only divine health, because that's about divine health. See, people do it in the natural just for health. Right. We're doing it for divine health. Okay. People do things, they behave and dress a certain way and do certain things for their own promotion. No. We're doing it because these are the things that Father has for us and we want to cooperate with Him. So just tonight as we begin to worship, as we begin to sing, let the Lord touch your heart. You know, just begin to say, I want God's presence like a fire. Don't go, because too many people do that. They just start pouting and they just cry babies. They just give up. Or they just put it off for another day. Don't do that. That's not hunger and thirsting. That's not faith. That's the opposite. And so that's murmuring and complaining, really. That's all it is. Any sticking forth the bottom of the lip. In fact, the Lord says you're not going to get anything so long as you're sticking forth the bottom of the lip. Isaiah 58. Pouting. But you know God, what God said is true. And you're not self-justifying or creating a condition, a particular unique condition that suits you and makes you feel better about why you don't, whatever. You know, come on. Just look, here's what Father's promised. This is what He wants for us. This is what He's willed. So we're going to get into this tonight. And I want to, by help of the grace of the Lord, I want to show you how committed Father is. I want to show you how committed Father is to having His will established in our life, to blessing us, to freely giving things to us. And then we've got to stand back and we've got to with an honest and sincere heart, we've got to look at how much we really are pursuing and persevering, pursuing the things so we know exactly what Father wants and what He has for us and how to do it. And then persevering in it, knocking, persevering until what he's promised is ours. Hallelujah. And it works in every dimension. It works in every dimension of faith. There's always going to be an asking. God will just give us confidence, and then we'll pursue it. We'll go investigate. We'll go look. Some of you have done it with your house, maybe. If God blessed you with that house, and that's from the Lord, you did it with your house. Huh? You asked the Lord. Then you went out, and what'd you do? You investigated. You looked at the mortgages and whatnot, right? Remember all the different interest rates and what you could and could not afford. That's seeking. Huh? You found out what you could do. You went back, you sharpened your pencil, you tightened your belt. Huh? Yeah. You looked at when are they going to get a raise? How are you going to, you managed all that stuff. And then you stepped out and you said, yeah, I'll do it for 30 years. Here, I'm your bond slave. Put the handcuffs on. Clip, clip. Hey? Or you just stepped out, you know, maybe you didn't even think that far. You got some kind of exit strategy going on in your head. Oh, well, you know, we can always get out of this. Didn't know the economy was going to crash and it was going to be worth 50% less. But not saying anything that. You stepped out then, and you stepped out. And you broke barriers of fear, and you broke barriers of concern, and you broke barriers of limitation. Nothing's different than things of the Spirit. In the end, you're never going to know this until you do it. It's just all going to be theoretical. Huh? Huh? Jesus. Do you guys have a lab here or just a classroom? You know what I'm saying? You guys do anything with your knowledge or is it all just over here theoretical? You know, there's not going to be much profit in just sitting around in the lab. Well, first of all, in the classroom, and then there's not going to be much profit just sitting around the lab. Somebody's got to get into manufacturing. Somebody's going to have to start doing something with this thing. There's not going to be a profit until something started being made. Oh, mangeli posipara. Am I talking to you? You're listening to me. I'm talking about the fire of God. I'm talking about His presence like a fire. I'm talking about His presence like a rain. Hallelujah. I'm talking about you moving in faith and signs, wonders, and miracles. I'm talking about you living in demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. I'm talking all of us. When I say you, I'm saying me. I'm just talking on behalf of the Lord usually when I'm saying you. So I said, why don't you just say we more of the time? Because the Lord doesn't need it. He's got it. And many times I'm just talking in the first person. I'm prophesying, I'm prophesying, but I'm not going, thus saith the Lord, here's what I have to say. I'm just speaking as an oracle of the Lord on His behalf. That's what I'm supposed to be doing. And if you think I'm leaving myself out, I'm not. I'm included. Praise Amen. God. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm hungry. And I'm thirsty. Amen. I know what it's like to walk over to someone and just touch them and they're immediately healed. And say nothing. I read that today and Jesus walked in Peter's house and his mother-in-law lay there sick and he walked over and just touched her. Fever immediately left her. I know what that's like. I know what it's like. Has nothing to do with a power surge of, well, I feel really good about myself. Look at what I did. It's the manifest presence of God that comes with it. It's just, whoosh, it's this glory of heaven, this glory realm. You get the virtue. You just become a vessel of the virtue and the power and the glory. It's a beautiful thing. We want everybody to experience this. If you want these things of God to become rich in your life, you need to understand you've got to allow the anointing to flow out of you. Praise and worship is a part of that. Laying hands on the sick is a part of that. Ministering to people for whatever they need because you step into moving in the gift of faith, moving in the power of God, in other words. Hallelujah. He's just right there as soon as he sees somebody willing to do it, he's just right there to hook up with you. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know how Jesus went around telling everybody about him? You know how he went around telling everybody about him? Do you know how he went around telling everybody about him? It was so good. Huh? He getting everybody out of their problem. Anybody hurting, you're hurting in pain, huh? Tormented, sick, diseased. He came fix you. That's how he told everybody about him. Then we want to go around and tell everybody about him on an intellectual basis. And we're just like, this don't feel right. No, it don't feel right, does it? Huh? You need to get yourself a new style. That style ain't working. You need to get yourself a Holy Ghost move. You need to get a new style, a Holy Ghost style. You need to do it like Jesus did it. Hallelujah. You know, Jesus, by and large, is basically going around saying, you got a problem? You got need any problem? You have any problems? Huh? He was able to go around somebody before they even expressed his problems. Hey, there he comes. There's one. There he comes. An Israelite in whom there is no guile. Well, how do you know me? I knew you. I saw you over there in the fig tree. Wow. Come on, man. That's the way Jesus said to tell everybody about himself. That's the way he wants us to go around and tell everybody about him. Because then they're not some stuck in the rut, human expression of another ideology, another religious plan. Come on, man. Hallelujah. This is what God wants for us. And he's who's commanded is the one's going to supply. But you've got to do more than just ask. He didn't just say ask. And I want to get that with you tonight. I want to get ask, seek, knock. I want you to be able to see ask, seek, knock in every dimension in which it's applied. Before that, I just wanted to set you up before we start singing here. Ruthie Ann is getting ready to start singing here. Turn it up, baby. I can't hear it. I can't hear it. Just turn it up. And I want to hear can I hear the keyboard? Well, you can go ahead and get started because you're not waiting to the last minute. Otherwise, what's going to happen is you're going to discover you didn't have any oil. Because as soon as the master spoke, I don't have any oil. Well, and here it is right at the beginning of the church service. No oil. Oh, goodness gracious. We'll be back in about 30 minutes. Look, it's going to be done 30 minutes. We've got to be moving on. You got to be ready when the master speaks. It's not just about his coming. It's about every moving of God, being ready. Hallelujah. I got oil. My lamp is burning and my belt's on. I'm not around in here in my pajamas here tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I asked the Lord, I want to meet with you tonight. And then I got in the car and came over here. Amen. I'm pursuing. Hallelujah. And I'm going to lay hold on God and the things of faith, knowing that those things which he said he would do in the midst of his church is going to happen in this place. And I want you to know that too. And I want you to get good with a sharp two-edged sword, a killing every condemnation and every brow-beating thing and everything that tells you a failure and you can't do it. I want you to get good slicing and dicing, and cutting and killing, smashing. Just go right for the thing. I mean, the Lord didn't give us the butter knife of the Spirit. He gave us the sword of the Spirit. Hallelujah. He's been getting this butt knife for the Spirit. I can just kind of hurt something with a bug knife. Sword. You know, in the presence of the Lord Jesus, it's a sick-free zone, pain-free zone, sin-free zone, depression-free zone, torment-free zone. It's a zone of joy and love and peace. Zone of every good thing. And all you got to do is let him touch you. You got to be willing to let him touch you. And Jesus walked up to Peter's mother-in-law and he just touched her. When he touched her, his presence, his manifest presence and his touch. If there's anything God's people want to do is they want to learn how to cooperate with his manifest presence and touch. Religion will block you out of it. If you've got doubt and you're not certain concerning the will of God for your life, it will hinder you. There'll be way too many opportunities for the enemy to bring hindrances into your life and keep you from this realm. You just got to be sold, completely sold out on the concept of God's love for us, that not only has he willed all of these things for us that we read in the Bible concerning all that pertains to life and godliness, not only has he willed for us in his word all these things that pertain to all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm, not only has he willed for us in his word that we have all authority in his name, that these signs shall follow them that believe in his name, we cast out devils and speak with new tongues, and we drink any deadly thing, shall not hurt us, we take up serpents, we suffer no harm, we lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. Not only is it to just hear and read that these works shall you do and greater works than these, but to be able to go ahead now and be fully persuaded
that God, who's not only willing to do it right now, has made it willing to do it and declared these things, that this is what he wants, but he's made them available. These things available to you right now. They're available to you right now. That for him to be magnified, he describes what it looks like for him to be magnified. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to every person. To one is given the word of knowledge, to another the word of wisdom, to another discerning of spirits, to another the working of miracles, gifts of healing, gifts of faith, prophecy, tongues, interpretation of tongues. You know, when we begin to be, I'm not used to asking Father and not getting what I asked for, okay? So I'm not going to stand here and say, Lord, baptize me in the fire and not have some fire. Just stand around and just, you know, ask for things that you never expect to get. And no sane person asks for anything that they don't expect to get. Well, it's a place of humility, too. You don't just walk up to somebody, you know they're not going to give it to you, but you're going to go ahead and ask them anyways. That's not true. I don't believe there's a single person in this place. right now that would be willing to live in a cardboard box on the street. You know why? Because you know that there's a better life for you to live, and it's been made available. There's too many alternatives, and there's too many options, and there's too many provisions for you to just, in the natural, instead of you just being out there living on 6th and F Street tonight, okay, and pushing a shopping cart around. And so I'm so happy that all of you got that. But I'm tired of seeing God's people in the Spirit pushing a shopping cart around, okay? And my Rithiana, when she was a little girl, she said 4 years old, she said, Dad, I guess all of those people would just be really happy so long as you just give them cans. They like the cans. Because all she could ever see is they push these shopping carts around, and they're just full of cans. And, you know, it's just about time that you and I just say, wait a minute, no, we're not going to live like this. We recognize this is God's will for our life. We recognize that these things are available, and we're not willing to live without them. Hallelujah. And see, that's just it. Because if there are people that teach, oh, you don't know whether you're going to get healed or not, whether God's going to answer your prayers or not, who knows? Well, you're never going to get anything like that because you've got too many opportunities for Satan to come in, for doubt to come in, for all the hindrances that exist both in the spiritual and in the natural to stop you. Forget about it. You've got to be sold out on these things. You're going to have to be sold out on the Word of God. The Word of God, the hearing of the Word of God and grabbing hold of the Word of God is going to produce or bring in your life faith. And in many respects, it's going to bring an opportunity of faith because the Word was preached to Israel, didn't profit them, because it wasn't mixed with faith. They were in the move of God. They were in the right church. They had the right pastor. They had the glory of God with them. They had signs and wonders and miracles around about them. But they weren't willing to participate with it, so it didn't profit them anything because it wasn't mixed with faith. And the Holy Spirit is here tonight to give you faith. And I'm going to talk to you tonight about how interested the provision, the radical provision that God has given to us for answers to prayer, of how he wants us to be able to receive everything that we have need of and look to him for it. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, he is not interested in you providing for yourself. I want you to open your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 7. God is not excited, stoked, impressed because you provide for yourself. And you're going to stand in his presence and going, you're amazing. You just provided for yourself. You really didn't even need me. I mean, you took care of it all, the food. I mean, my goodness, you didn't have to bother me one little bit. People always ask me, like, well, we don't want to bother God, like he's busy or something, and it's going to be aggravating. Should we bother? Father wants us to live in a place of relying upon him for a life that only he has. People run around thinking sin's so good. Well, if sin's so good, God would have done some of it. Hello. People run around saying this thing's that good and that. If it was good, God would have done it. He's a good God, loves good things. He ain't done none of that stuff. And he's trying to get us out of that mess, the mess that we've been living in, the realms of human limitation. Father's original plan wasn't for us to live under the kinds of confines and restraint and distraction and turmoil and problems that we live in. And Jesus Christ came as the doorway so we could enter out of this realm, back over into the other realm where he is, get out the realm where Satan's power and all the things that is confusing and all the things of death that belongs to the realm of men in the world, and step over into the realm of God. The doorway's open. His name's Jesus. He said, he's calling. He's saying, come. And Father's trying to convince us. He's trying. And he's given us a whole Bible filled with the expressions of his own word and of his own will. And you just got through Matthew chapter 6, if you're in Matthew chapter 7. We'll pretend anyways. Because you know Matthew chapter 6, you know what's going on. Hallelujah. And in Matthew chapter 6, you know, Pokorana saya, Tele, yeah. Now, that's the Torah, yeah. Yeah, that's right. And this, you just want to go real deep in that right there. Because if you, the deeper you go in that right there, the more you'll be able to receive. The more you'll be able to live in, function, walk in, manifest presence of Jesus. People just don't want to go that deep. They want to stay in control. Control of what? Control of what? You know, you want to just float away in the presence of the Lord. You want to go so deep in the things of his joy and the things of his peace and the things of his love that you've forgot, you've lost all control. You don't even know what control is anymore. You come under the mandate of heaven, and the Holy Ghost now has rule and control. And then he begins to supply to you holy emotions that otherwise you could never have. See, God the Holy Ghost alone has access into things in your life that you and I don't have access. I don't have access to the deep realms of his joy, of his peace, of his love. All these things, I don't have access to that. You don't have access to that. Only Holy Ghost has access to that. And he wants to so supply out of the deepest part of our being this wellspring of life. He wants to so supply to us out of the deepness of our life, out of the deepness of our emotion, out of the deepness of our passion, this realm of glory. But we just simply are stuck. God wants to get us unstuck. And one of the things he talks about in Matthew chapter 6, he says, listen, you're going to have to stop taking consideration for what you're going to eat. You're going to have to stop, you're just going to have to forget it. You're going to have to recognize that I'm going to take care of you. I took care of the birds, didn't I take you? And he gives us proofs. He quantifies it, you know. Look at the grass of the field. Look at the birds of the air. I did that. Isn't that beautiful how he lays that out for us? Will you quit doing what it is you're doing and recognize that I'll provide for you as soon as you lose control of what you think you can do for yourself? And then he brings us over into Matthew chapter 7. And he tells us, get out. Basically, he's telling us, get out of all of our finger-pointing, accusation, and complaining, and mess. And, you know, with words like judge not, be not judged. Don't go try to get a log out of your brother's eye when you got a speck out of your brother's eye when you got a log in yours. It's like, get out of your stuff, all your human business, all your own human thinking. That's what he's saying. And I want you to turn your heart over. Get over here. Come, look up here. That's basically what the Lord's saying. Stop looking around. Stop trying to figure it out. Stop trying to compare yourself among each other. Stop trying to straighten each other out. Look up here now. And now he's got our attention. And then that brings us right there. By the time we got finished with that brings us to about verse 8. Verse 7, okay? Hallelujah. And he says, ask. Hallelujah. And ask means ask. Ask, and it shall be given to you. Is there any more simple formula than that? This is Father's desire. He's going to try to convince us here. Ask, and it shall be given to you. He says, seek, and you shall find. And he says, knock, and it shall be opened to you. And he's saying, look. He's saying, ask it. Ask whatever you want of me. I'm going to give it to you. Just pursue it now. Know that it's yours. That's the seeking of it. You've asked for it. Now I'm giving it to you. Now it's available. Go reach out there and grab a hold of it and knock. In other words, don't even let up until it's in your hands and you fully embrace and you fully have the full benefits of whatever it is that you wanted, whatever it is that you asked for me. I'm right now in pursuit of the full benefits of all of the blessings of the gifts of the Spirit that have been made available to me in every dimension of this wonderful, abundant life that has been given. And I'm not going to cut it short just in one dimension. I'm going to go for all the blessings of God. He said, I bless you with some spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Figure out what they are. I'll give you a couple of clues, but you're going to have to really search hard to even be able to figure out the clues. He didn't say, I bless you. I've given it to you. It's yours. I've supplied it. How do we get it? Take a drink. And what's going to happen? It's just going to bust loose on the inside of you. And it's like nothing. All we got to do is just do this simple thing. We just take a little sip. And he says, I'm going to do the rest. I'm going to supply the water of life, and I'm going to supply the rivers that are going to be a result. And all you got to do is sip. All you got to do is just open up your mouth. I mean, it's like he gives us the easiest part, and we try to flip it around on God and act like he can't hear. He's hard of hearing. Or somehow there's something about us he just doesn't like. I don't have it right. I'm going to have to talk to Pastor Mark. Somehow I don't got it right. Or whatever it is. There's therefore now no condemnation of those in Christ Jesus. God the Holy Ghost comes to show you what the blood of Jesus Christ did for you. God the Holy Ghost comes to show you how God's grace has been given to you and supplied to you in such a way that he has made you everything that is acceptable unto him. Now, if you can't hear from the Holy Ghost, you can't hear from nobody. Hallelujah. And so, you know, quit, you know, speck hunting. If you speck hunting, you're logger. Are you with me? If you're a speck hunter, that means you're a logger. I'm looking for speck. I'm just looking for some little problem in somebody's life. Huh? You're a logger. You got a big log. It's proof. It is proof. And so don't speck hunt, okay? Because, you know, that's just going to give a wrong witness to yourself. And then the Lord emphasized, he says, what does he say? For every once in a while, he that asks is going to get it. I got a lotto going on in heaven, and, there's bingo night, kingdom of God. And, he doesn't say any of that. Hey, no, if it be my will. Did he say that?
No.
He said, look what he said. Now, don't edit it. Everyone, and the word means all. Greek word panta, it means all. Everyone who asks receives. Now, is that going to be put to a test in your life? Is that going to be examined in your life, whether you're going to believe God or believe you or believe circumstance or believe situation? Yeah. But guess what? You get through the fight of it, you get through the battle of it to where it's settled forever and ever, and the proof is established in your life that you believe this, and you won't have to be waiting a month, a year, or whatever to get the answer to prayer. It'll be right when you call. You'll be able to move and function and to get to faith in the realms of the Holy Ghost to where that you have a supply not only for yourself, but for everyone that asks. And until you got a supply for you, listen, it's going to be hard to have something to give to someone else. Listen, everybody who has something to give at some time in their life received it from heaven. I know people who've gone through hard times in their life, but there was an event before those hard times where they received something from heaven. And the beautiful thing is, once you receive something from heaven, you get to keep it forever, by and large. I mean, you can abdicate, you can get out of it, you quit believing, but as long as you're willing to believe, it's yours. And I've watched it, people, this happen in the gifts of spirit. People who step into a gift of healing, gift of faith, gift of miracles, they go through some devastating events in their life. And if you looked at some of the devastating events in their life, behind the scenes, you'd go, my goodness, how are they doing anything? But what was going on on the outside, what everybody was seeing, they're up on the platform, they're going after it, they're preaching, they're not letting up, they're believing God for great things. Because they're not letting the circumstances of their life, the hard situations of their life, dictate them to them their limitation. They let the Word of God rule over them and give them an unlimited realm to function in. And at some point in their life, they had a revelation of that. Oh, wait a minute, I've got an unlimited realm to function in. I've had an encounter with God, I know this to be true. And so now, it's like a friend of mine. You've heard me tell the story. I love to tell the story because, you know, he was in a crusade. The crusade was going for, I think, like 12 nights. On the 12th night, he kept asking them every night, put a rail up. They didn't put a rail up. On the 12th night, it was rainy. He slipped off. He fell all the way down to the bottom. Here's the preacher, the man of God. Signs, wonders, miracles happening everywhere. He's got mud all over him. He's totally upset. He's looking. He's now going to go look for the person that he told to put that rail up because he's going to smack him. Okay? And while he's going looking for this person, you know, going to smack them, they brought in front of him a girl who was totally blind. Her eyes were going all over the place. And they said, please, Pastor, pray. And so he just stopped and he laid his hands on him. As soon as he laid his hands on the girl. And he's got in his mind, I'm going to go smack that guy. But there's something bigger, the anointing of the Lord Jesus Christ. He laid his hands on the girl and said, be healed in Jesus' name. And he just started to move right off. The girl immediately saw, and he's going looking for the guy who didn't put the rail up. Okay? What is he allowing to dictate to him? What he does. He didn't say, oh, well, I can't pray for you right now. I'm in a bad attitude. I'm going to go smack somebody. Or, you know, I just don't feel like it right now. Get out of my way. See how muddy I am. I'm muddy. My clothes are muddy. No. What is he? What is he? He's allowing his whole life to be dictated to him by the Word of God. He doesn't have value within the framework of his own self-consciousness. He's given himself completely over to having the Lord Jesus revealed, magnified, glorified, and highly exalted in his life. This is what every one of God's believers have got to come to. At some point, Jesus Christ has got to become bigger than your circumstance. At some point, you've got to have an encounter with God that becomes bigger to you than your problems and your issues and what people said about you in kindergarten. It's got to become bigger to you than all the ideas that you, concepts that you have of yourself, to where that really nothing has any meaning or value to your life except for this wonderful privilege an opportunity that we've been given to be the sons of God and to represent the kingdom of God. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, I don't have, if, you know, when we go play golf, I'm probably going to play bad golf, and it doesn't bother me at all. I'm happy all the time because I have no identity in it. But if I lay hands on the sick and they don't get healed, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm one miserable puppy. I'm kicking chairs. I'm upset. Are you with me? Because this ain't supposed to be. I thought the thing actually was glued and it wasn't going to come apart, though. I'm glad I didn't kick it harder. I mean, I'm upset. I'm saying, like, what's wrong, you foul spirit of hell, you lying devil, you thing that is, whatever you are, that's against righteousness and the truth of the Lord Jesus. I'm after it. I'm not going to abide it because my whole identity is wrapped up in Jesus. My whole identity is wrapped up in what he said I'm supposed to have. I'm not going to allow my body, I'm not going to allow my soul, I'm not going to allow my spirit, I'm not going to allow myself to be any other thing than what God described me to be. Now, that's the identity that God wants you to have your whole life wrapped up in. And believe this, when we're willing to, out of that, we're going to begin to participate with God, the Holy Spirit, in an entirely different level. Because reality of it is, you're no longer distracted. You're very, very focused. And being very, very focused, you're hearing exactly what he's saying, and you're getting information that otherwise you would go, what did he say? The Lord says, everyone that asks receives. He that seeks finds. And the one that has that is knocking at the door, it's going to be open. And you know, we jump over and we look in Matthew chapter 7. You jumped over and you look in, for example, in Luke chapter 11 and verse 8. And you see what the Lord says about why men ought to pray and the disposition of our heart, of our boldness. He says, look, the guy comes over to his neighbor's house and he needs some food because he just got a visitor come in late at night and he has no food to set before him. And he goes banging on his friend's door. And the friends in there tells everybody to be quiet. Shh. Maybe he'll think nobody's in here. But he keeps on knocking. And then finally he's knocking and knocking and knocking. And finally in exhaustion he goes, hey, look, my children and I, we in bed. And we're sleeping. Go away. And he continues to knock harder. That's the knocking the Lord's talking about here. And the scripture says that he's not going to rise and give to him because he's a friend. He's going to rise and give to him because he won't go away. Because of his boldness. He's relentless. He's not like, oh, Lord, I know you don't really probably have any time for me. I don't want to be bugging you. And who knows whether it's your will or not. But, you know, I've got this need. Now, Father wants boldness. I mean, boldness and confidence and assurance are all parts of faith. They are fruits of the Spirit. If you want to see how important they are, then listen to the disciples as they pray and say, Lord, give us boldness so we can function in the anointing, is basically what they said. Give us boldness. Grant unto your servants boldness by stretching forth your hand to do signs and wonders by your holy child Jesus. Basically, they're saying, God, give us a Holy Ghost boldness so that we can function in anointing and do signs, wonders, and miracles. And what happened? Place was shaken. Come on. I'm like, give me a break. I want to get in a prayer meeting with God's people in a church somewhere where the place gets shaken. Come on, man. Come on. Somebody said, why you got to be honest all the time? Because I'm going for the shaking. I want to have some pure faith, some real faith. I want the heart to be feeling what the lips are speaking. Otherwise, you are running jeopardy. Your lips draw nigh to him, but your heart's far from him. Your heart better be feeling what your lips are speaking. God wants it that way. God, the Holy Ghost, produces it that way. Huh? That's right. And I'm a shepherd. And I can spot diseased critters, sheep, cows. I can spot them. It's easy to spot them. They look sad. They're not all perky. Hey, anybody else in here been around animals? Kevin has. They're not all perky. You can just tell there's something wrong. They're not perky. And they're not eating. Look at that. Huh? A healthy cow might be laying down, but she's sitting there going. And her head's up, and she looks all perky. If she's down like this, and there's something wrong. Man, people aren't feeding. I'm gonna get you healed. I'm gonna reach my hand in there. I'm gonna find out what's wrong. And you can scream and holler all you want and say, you're condemning me. You say whatever you want, we're gonna get you healed. Because Father's gonna have his pastors after his own heart who's gonna heal the sheep. Hallelujah. I'm gonna sit around and watch a bunch of wounded, sick, diseased sheep. Huh? My goodness, you wanna be healthy, then you can have nice, you know, wool, and you'll really produce. You have a good, healthy wool. We shear you and sell it. Go do a mass evangelist crusade with it. Go reach the lost, you know, plant a church, do an orphanage, and then not only would you be producing wool so we can go sell that wool and do the things of the kingdom of God, but you also be producing babies right, left, and center. Amen. And it's lots of fun having the little babies running around. Amen. That's what we're doing. We want Gondabai and Tessadayari. We want a bunch of people full of boldness and confidence. And if you don't have the boldness and the confidence, listen, I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit's ready to supply it. He's written, you may have a battle. You may have to deal with the lies of intimidation and condemnation. And the more that you've allowed that, the more you've created that rut for your life, the more that you've accommodated those things, the harder it's going to be to get past it. You know, I was telling my wife today, I said, listen, I'm going to go on a diet till I can't pinch an inch no more because I'm pinching an inch, and I don't like that. And, you know, I believe in divine health. I want divine health. And I know to have divine health means that I'm going to be giving myself to being healthy. Yeah. I'm going to be divine health and eat a bunch of greasy food, and all this, just live on... Super gulps and Big Macs. I don't care how much you ask for divine health. You're not going to have the divine health. Huh? Super gulps, right? And Big Macs and then coffee in between times. You're going to be sick. You're going to be sick. You can pray all you want. You're not seeking things after the proper manner. You're not pursuing divine health. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. I want you to grab a hold of that in the realms of the Spirit. Because if you start seeking God according to do His order, according to the order that He has prescribed, you're going to have measurable growth in your life. But if I've gone a long time, and let's say I got up to 320 pounds before lights came on and go, ooh, I can pinch a foot. I'm going to be a whole lot longer getting through the process, man. It's going to be a whole lot more difficult. It's going to be a whole lot more challenging. It's going to take a whole lot more discipline. Same way with people who's allowed condemnation run rampant through their life and intimidation and fear. You're going to have a battle. You got a battle on your hands, man. It's time for a change. It's time. It's time for a change. It's time. It's time to do miracles. Let's do miracles. Listen, you got a lot of fear. You got a lot of self-consciousness. You got a lot of problems to get over. And if you're the provider for yourself and you always doing it and you're not going to ask anybody for any instructions or whatever else going on in your life, because the pride of life run ruin on every good thing that God is doing. Let me say that again because that sounded good. The pride of life will run ruin on every good thing that God is doing. You want to get out of that. You want to humble yourself. Asking is humility. Lord, I need. Father wants you to walk in humility. Huh? And he wants you to ask in faith. Hallelujah. And when we go to seeking, we have a promise from the Lord. What is the promise? We hear this wonderful promise. It says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. For everyone that comes to God must believe that he is here. He exists. He is. Okay? And that he is a rewarder of those who diligently pursue him. Those who lay hold on him. Those who seek him, in other words. And understanding, if I'm asking God, I'm saying, Lord, I'm going to function in the word of knowledge. You know what I'm going to be doing? I'm going to be pursuing it. You know what I'm going to be doing? Everybody that is credible, word of knowledge, I'm going to listen to what they say. I'm going to hear what they say. I'm going to be able to quote it. I've got friends of mine who I learned this from, watching and looking at their life and saying, look, tell me. What specific things did God do in your life that you believe brought you to this place? And they, you know, I was telling a person the other day, I said, ask so-and-so to quote, to just do one of A.A. Allen's sermon for you. Because at a drop of hat, he'll start at the beginning of the sermon and he'll quote the whole thing. And it's not the only one. He was with Oral Roberts one day and he started just quoting one of Oral Roberts' sermons. And Oral Roberts picked right up where he left off and went ahead and quoted it, and then my friend picked it back up and quoted it. What was going on? Somebody was laying hold on something. Somebody was pursuing something. Not just sitting around. If God, if you get around to it, you know where I live. Let me remind you my address. 4060 Cary Way. That's 92028 zip code. And I'll be here. Just anytime, call me up. Ain't nothing going to happen. You ain't getting anything. You're not. You're never going to go where God wants you to go because he said he connects, ask and seek and knock together for a reason. I'm talking to you about these things, people, because if you want to see the growth of the power of God in your life, you want to see miracles in your life, what you need to do, one of the best things to do is just give yourself to, you know, listening to the miracle scriptures. You know, let me just help you understand what I'm just trying to break this out for you. If Ann and I are moving in faith for something, we're believing God for something, you know what I do? I'll get every scripture out on faith that there is. I'll just go over the scriptures on faith. I bathe myself in the Word of God. I bathe myself in faith. I build myself up in the Holy Ghost. Build myself up in my most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. I just do everything God says to do. I pursue it. I give myself to it. Out of that, there is a divine ignition. There is a divine jump start, as it were. There is a divine event that I'm just there. I have it. I speak it. It happens. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. This is true. We want this to be for you. I don't limit myself to what I can make. I don't think, well, how am I going to make this? Maybe I'll learn how to crochet and do a bunch of hats. I crochet a bunch of hats, and then I offer them all up for sale for $200 each. No. Father's going to give me whatever I want. He's going to give me whatever I asked him. Because, see, his word abides in me. I got his word, said he's going to do it. See that? John 15:7 said, if you abide in me and my word abides in you, whatever you want is yours. Let me give this to you. Whatever you want is yours. So I said, I'm just trying to find the right thing to do with my life. Whatsoever you do. That means you get to choose. Pick a number, win a prize. I don't care what it is. Whatever you do will prosper. All you got to do is get your relationship right. That's it. That's it. Hello. It's so simple. It is not complicated. It's by the word of God that I'm going to prosper. It's by the word of God that I'm going to do valiantly. It's because I'm going to meditate upon his word that's going to give me the ability to succeed. I mean, we can read the verse of Scripture in Joshua all we want. We can read this verse of Scripture in Psalms all we want, in Isaiah all we want. But it's got to come to a point where we actually do that, where we now start meditating on the Word. What am I doing now? I'm seeking. I'm pursuing. I'm laying hold on something, and I'm not going to stop, and I'm not going to let up till I have in my possession that which I desired, till I've entered into that realm which I am desiring to go into. Because I'm knocking on a door. Why? I want to go inside.
Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Thank you, living God. Now, I want you to quit playing patty cake religion, pretend Christianity, kind of asking God, and start getting a hold of these things in such a way in your relationship with the Lord that now what Father has willed becomes a living reality, because it's not what we have willed. He has willed this. He has willed that whatever we ask, we'll get it. Amen. He has willed to have this kind of relationship. He has willed to show forth that He has established His covenant in our life by our prospering and success in everything that we do, and especially with respect to moving in the anointing and the power and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost. And that's what we want. Come on, man. Ain't nothing more fun than pulling some child out of a wheelchair. Huh? Ain't nothing more fun than seeing somebody's got a cut off arm, have it grow out. And nothing more fun than seeing somebody's totally mentally insane, completely restored to mental sanity and mental health. And nothing more fun than seeing somebody's got pneumonia all of a sudden start breathing. They've been coughing and gasping for air for the past 3 months, and now they're breathing fine. Nothing more fun than seeing a migraine headache go away, whatever torment or sickness or disease or whatever sin or yoke or bondage. Nothing so wonderful as seeing the heroin addict completely delivered from heroin, and see an alcoholic completely delivered from alcohol, never drink another drink again. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I love Josh Nichols there and Blind, his testimony. He says, it's like you reached inside of me and you pulled something out of me. So I don't have any desire for that. I've had a battle all my life. But you reached inside and you pulled something out. It's not there anymore. And nothing more fun than doing this stuff. My identity's all wrapped up in that. It's got to happen. It ain't going to be any other way than that. Because it's what Father has willed. And I've resigned myself to His will. My whole identity, my whole purpose, my whole happiness, my whole everything's there. Golf, nothing. Job, nothing. Meaningless. What people think, meaningless. However, if those things are meaningful, they'll run interference with your identity in Christ. If your identity, who are you? Well, I am so-and-so. Huh? I'm Reverend, Doctor, Pastor, Almighty Bishop, Archangel. So-and-so. Well, it's going to run interference. You can be that, but you can't be what Jesus said. I'm Dr. Fahrenheit. I have so many degrees, I've lost track. But then you can be that. You can be that, but you can't then be what Jesus said. You know, where is our identity? Where is our life? Where is our value? Where our identity, our life, our value, that's where our meaning is. That's where our passions are going to be. That's where our hunger is. I got to have it. Brother Yun's going to be here this next month. And he said, I'm going to tell you how I gained success in the kingdom of God. How I received from heaven. He said, when I was the little guy, my family sent me on the street to beg because I was the best beggar in the family. And I was such a good beggar because there was no one who's going to turn me away. I was on you, man. You could slap me. You could push me down. You could insult me. And I'm gonna pull on your coattail all the more. He said, all I did is when I got born of the Spirit and came in the kingdom of God, I just did that to the Father. Hey, 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 hey. That's what Father says to do. Huh? Most people never read the scripture, command ye me, says the Lord. Huh? Oh, I'm just going to be humble. I'm just going to accept whatever I get. And, Lord, I'm just so happy just to have you.
Give me a break. He's supposed to be being magnified in your life. If you're so happy just to have him, you got everything, man. Woo! You happy to have him. You fundamentally happy to have his will, and you don't want to in any way shortchange him or misrepresent him. We're having it your way, God. Father, today, from here on out, we're going to have it your way. I know I've been willing to be sick, but you're not willing for me to be sick, so I'm not going to be willing to be sick. Sickness, you're done. I smash you. You have no hold on me. I was raised by super faith people. Hallelujah. It's just really faith people, you know. My mother would be talking like this. Mom, it sounds like you got a cold. I don't have a cold. Mother, why is your nose stopped up? I have no idea, but I don't have a cold. The redeemed of the Lord shall not say that I'm sick. I'm going to tell you right now, she would not lay down to anything. She would not. And I got a whole company of other people just the same way. And you'd find no sickness put them down. And they went from strength to strength. They didn't go from another sickness to another sickness. Whatever virus comes along, I'm getting it. It's whatever virus comes along, I'm not getting it. And anybody listening to me is not getting it either. And it just so happens to be, if I just happen to get the virus, I'm going to tell you right now, it ain't mine. I'm smashing a thing in the meantime. I'm going to tell you right now, it has no hold on me. It has no claim on me. I'll give it no hold. I'll give it no claim. I said to Father, this is Father, heal me. I pursue this thing, and I'm not letting up till it's fully in my possession. And all the time it's mine. Amen.
Amen.
Now, all the time it's mine, I just want you to hold your finger here for just a second on Matthew chapter 7. And I want to show you here now in Luke. In Mark, let's just get all the Gospels in here, okay? I won't leave any of the Gospels out. So Mark chapter 11, and let's look at Mark chapter 11, verse 24 in this. In Mark chapter 11, verse 34, it says, therefore I say to you, whatever you desire, desire, whatever you desire, what do you desire? What is it that you desire? What is it that you desire? A man of faith said, I desire Rolls Royce. He got it. He desired it. Oh, you can't have no... Well, you know what? He was also busy in the kingdom of God, so he wanted Rolls Royce. Give him a Rolls Royce. Who cares? You speck hunter. Who cares? You just want to run around judging after your own understanding? You logger, you. Who cares if he's got a Rolls Royce or whatever he's got? It doesn't even matter. What's he doing in the kingdom? Who's he getting it from? Who does he say gave it to him? Hello? Where did you get your little VW? Oh, you got that for yourself. You bought that for you. Oh, come over here. Let me pat you on your back. Is that supposed to be some, you know, elevated position because you did it? I'd say that's a demotion. Hallelujah. Listen to me. I say when you got it where God did it all for you and you're not a self-made person anymore, you a God-made person. Everything you got, you didn't get because by your sweat of your brow and your own hard work and effort, but God freely gave it to you. You moving somewhere now. You somebody. In reality, you somebody in the kingdom of God instead of being somebody in the earth and in your own mind. Based upon your own set of ethics. Based upon your own laws of integrity. Which is so self-centered and so governed by human understanding. Forget about it. Lord won't just give it to us. Hallelujah. You might as well just accept you a beggar anyways. Amen. Hallelujah. And you don't have nothing. Somebody else out there working so desperately hard to prepare your food for you. Huh? It's called the agricultural community. And if they weren't out there working hard, your money's nothing. That food is everything. They working hard. They're getting up early in the morning to prepare the food for America and for the world. Come on, think about it now. I mean, we just start flipping things around. Start looking at them from a little bit more of a real perspective here. And then they work all they want. But if God, our Heavenly Father, wasn't in His mercy and grace, sending His rain upon the wicked and causing His sun to shine upon the unrighteous, It wouldn't produce anything. Huh? Cain, because of his sin and iniquity, God said, the earth will not yield for you. I don't care how good of a farmer you are. It'll produce for everybody else. But you, I don't care. You do everything you're supposed to do. It will not work for you because I'm the one in charge of who's going to have a green thumb. I'm in charge of whether that ground is going to produce. But of course, we know that in the laws of God, in the natural laws of God, if you want to be successful in agriculture, what are you going to do? You can go learn. You're going to pursue these things. So I want you to look at this. Whatever you desire, when you ask or when you pray, believe that you already got it. Or if you don't want to go that far, just believe that it's already on its way. But really, it's believe that you've received. You know, people try to make a, sometimes people, you see people make a formula out of it, but you know, or supposedly make a formula out of it, but you don't really know that. You don't know that. You might be a speck hunter again. Huh? I believe that I've received theirs for its mine, and it doesn't seem like they're getting anywhere. You know what? They're breaking through. At least they're quoting the Word of God. What are you doing? What are you doing when you're saying, listen to them? That's called specking. Yeah. That's speck hunting. Well, you're judging now. You're judging, because when the Lord says, judge not that you be not judged, he's not talking about his judgment. He's talking men judging one another after their own understanding of things. You got to stop that, because it's reality. I'm going to show you at the end of this that it'll keep you from all that God's promised. You got to shut that shop down. Close it down. Fact, fill it with concrete or burn it down, whatever the case may be. Shut the thing down so it can't ever open up again. Huh? Hallelujah. Fire everybody that worked in that department in your life. Fire them. Are you listening to me? Do you understand what I just said, or do I need to say it in another way? You're going to have to shut these imaginations down. Shut these offenses down. Shut this human thinking down, human perception, human reasoning. I'm telling you, it's going to stop you. The more that you give your life to yourself, the more impossible it is for you to shut those departments down. They will rule you. When your self rules you, when your identity is wrapped up in earthly things, you cannot shut that department down. The only way you can shut that department down, the hardest, most, listen, one, the most, do you listen to me?
Yes.
The most impossible thing for a man to do is to deny himself. How are you going to deny yourself? You are you, and you are you, you is all you are ever going to get. You are you, and you are is all you are ever going to get. God gives us the capacity by the anointing to deny ourselves. Because now we get to listen to the Holy Ghost. I don't know how to deny myself by myself. I get to interact with the Holy Ghost. I've learned how to let him rule. I've seen the pearl of great price. I've seen the treasures hid in the field. I've had a revelation of Jesus. I've had a revelation of the manifest presence of God. I know the touch of God. I know how to yield to him. I know how to hear his voice, and now I'm growing in that. But if I didn't know how, there's no way I could display self or stop self or not go with my own ideas, because then what am I going to do? I'm going to say, honey, now what should we do? Should we get smooth peanut butter or chunky? Should we get white bread? Everything. I mean, just be asking. If I'm not going to go from it with my own ideas, my own self, I'm going to have to ask somebody else. Right? So the Lord's looking to you and me and saying, listen, I want to talk to you. I want to speak to you. I want to touch you. I want to supply you with these heavenly things so you don't rely on yourself. You come rely upon me. Now, I'm going to ask you to do a couple of things for me. I want you to be concerned no more, worried no more about what you shall eat, what you shall wear. Oh, he hit it right at the nail on the head, didn't he? Somebody said, Pastor, you go for the juggler every time. Somebody said, praise God, thank you for keeping it raw. I'm telling you, the one that wants to hit the nail on the head and keeping it raw is the Lord Jesus. I mean, he goes right for the main point. He doesn't hit around the periphery. He goes right to the most important issues. What we're wearing, what we're eating. But in the other, what we're eating, what we're wearing. Because we don't care about what we're eating. We don't care about what we're wearing until after we finish eating. Hallelujah. Tekonomo sepia teteya. Hallelujah. So he says, look, don't ask yourself anymore. Don't talk to yourself. Don't have a sit down with yourself and, you know, figure out what you and yourself and you are going to do. Me, myself, and I, we're working on a couple of plans right now. And I'm waiting for me to get back to I. And then, you know, come on. The Lord just says, listen, I want to show you. I want to train you how to hear my voice. I want to train you how to be ruled by me. I want to train you how to walk in the Spirit. I want to train you how to hear the word of knowledge. I mean, it's so beautiful. It's so beautiful. I am finding my life. I mean, it's just shocking me. It's shocking where I'm now starting to walk in the word of knowledge and function in the word of knowledge in very practical ways, knowing things that by the word of knowledge, here, knowing unseen things that I would not have known and then having them proven to me about my own life and things that I'm doing and is around me is a beautiful thing. And then to see it also then applied to other people's lives, you know, the Lord builds us up in confidence. We get a word of knowledge about something. We go, look, yeah, it's true. Well, and we do this thing and that thing, the other thing. Well, listen, I have pursued this. I asked for it. You will probably never hear me pray. And I will not say, you will probably never hear me pray without saying this. Hear me say this. Lord, I thank you. I don't say, Lord, please give to me. Lord, we're still waiting on you. What's up? Well, I say, thank you, Lord, for the word of knowledge, for the word of wisdom, for the discerning of spirits, for the working of miracles, for the gifts of healing, for the gift of faith, for prophecy, for tongues, for interpretation of tongues. Thank you, Lord, for dreams and visions. Hallelujah. You know, I lay down in bed tonight and just say, thank you, Lord, that you strengthen me. You come and speak to me tonight in the dreams and that you build me up and give me the ability to do everything that you purposed me to do by strengthening my faith. Lord, I thank you for the spirit of wisdom and revelation. I thank you for the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. I thank you, Lord. I won't let up on going through the list of things that the Lord has purposed for us to have in our life. I'm just saying, follow me. You ask, Father's going to give it to you. This is what he does. And he says, it's my good pleasure. He says, my good pleasure. So let's go back over here. I'm going to finish reading this. Ahead of myself. Wherefore, he says this, whatever you desire when you ask or pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have it. What's complicated about that? You know, you can keep your finger on that verse of Scripture because I'm going to come back and show you something else that can prevent and hinder you, okay? Because the Lord shows us a full picture. We're going to have to get the full picture. People think that Matthew chapter 7 shifting from one subject to another. It's not. It's all a part about how our interaction goes down with the Lord, how he wants to supply things to us, and then how we're going to be able to receive them. Because, see, he's abundantly supplied. See, understand this. If he spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all, how much more shall he also by him freely give us all things? Now, he wants us to understand he's freely supplied them. They're freely given. It's already done deal. We're already blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. He's provided for us everything that we have need of according to his riches and glory. The problem here is receiving. The problem is we allow things in our life of doubt and unbelief. You're not going to get anything. You can't receive anything from the Lord with doubt and unbelief. You can't receive anything from the Lord in a place of fear and condemnation. You can't receive anything from the Lord in this wavering and this waffling back and forth. So a big part of our growth and maturation is the Lord just bringing us out of the land of doubt and unbelief, bringing us out of the land of halting between two opinions, bringing us out of the land of fear and intimidation, bringing us out of the land of condemnation and accusation. And then we recognize, wait a minute, if I give my mouth and if I give my heart and if I give my life and my actions to these things, in my interaction with people around me, it's solidifying it in my life spiritually to where that's how my whole being is functioning. I'm not functioning under the anointing of the Holy Spirit and the leadership of the Holy Spirit. I'm functioning under a wrong realm of influence. So the Lord points out all these wrong realms of influence, and he says, deny it. Don't allow it. I've given you supernatural power. I've given you God power to pull down strongholds, to cast down imaginations, to bring every thought into the obedience of Christ Jesus, so that really the bottom line of it is you can be receiving and functioning and operating in all that I've freely given you. So going back over here to Matthew chapter 7 with me real quickly, he says, and he's gonna emphasize this. I command that cough to cease right now. Who's coughing? Let me just tell you. You're not interrupting me. I don't stand by and let that stuff happen. Choke it down. Deny it. Watch what happens. You deny it. You won't allow it. Huh? You won't allow yourself to cough. You won't allow yourself to throw up. You won't allow yourself. You just won't allow it. Huh? Are you, can you understand? I'm not allowing the pain. I'm not allowing whatever it is that's trying to impose itself on me. I'm not going to allow the sin. I'm not going to allow the suggestion. I'm not going to allow the hurt. It's all in the same realm, people. We say, well, how can you deny that? Do it. God's going to see you. Whatever. Just choke it down. Hallelujah. And allow it. Well, I got this irritation. Tell the irritation to go. Refuse it. Refuse it. You're not going to die. I promise you. It does not need to get out. It needs to go away. Okay? I mean, it needs to get out in one sense, but it doesn't need to get out that way. Am I making sense to you? Do these things. They work. They work. 20 years, a little over 20 years ago, I said to the Lord, I never want to throw up again. I'm never going to throw up again. Father, I ask you, I'll never want to have this terrible, the most terrible physiological function known to man, throwing up. To me, it is. And I haven't had that since. But there has been, there was a time right after that where I felt nauseous. I felt like I was going to throw up. And I swallowed it down. I said, no in Jesus' name. No in Jesus' name. No in Jesus' name. I'm telling you. It was about 20 years, a little over 20 years ago. No, I would not allow it. It was coming to say, you're going to throw up. Oh, yeah, I'm not throwing up. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in my body trying to throw up. I didn't really say that. But, I mean, it's that kind of a disposition. It's like, wait a minute, my body's not in control here. My spirit's in control here. The power of God in my life's in control here. My stomach's going to have to bow to the word of God. I don't care what kind of flips it's doing in there. Hello. Now, I hope that helps you, because I'm still talking about asking, seeking, and knocking. And saying, I will not have it any other way. I will not have it any other way. I will not have it any other way. Now, how are you going to come to that? You're going to have to get sick and tired of being sick and tired. You're going to have to get sick and tired. You're going to have to get fed up to here with you. And fed up to here with everything, every disappointment. And fed up to here with every sense of failure. And fed up to here with every condemnation and accusation. And fed up to here with being left out. And fed up to here with sitting on the sidelines. And fed up to here being fourth string on the football team. You might as well be the water boy. You have more action. Huh? Come on now. Come on now. And especially when Father's put us, everyone, on first string. He's put us, everyone, in first place. He's put us, everyone, right there with the Jesus. There are no second-class citizens in the kingdom of heaven. Not on God's account. People have made themselves second-class citizens. God hasn't. Huh? As far as that's concerned. Every one of you should be walking in such a great anointing. You all need a bunch of, bodyguards standing around you. I mean, there's no, really, honestly, there's no reason. There's just 1, 2, 3, 4, 10, 20, 30, maybe 100 men and women of faith and power running around. They, it's all God's people should be there. It's just that they stepped into it. They were relentless. They were going, I'm not going to have it any other way. I'm going to have these things. I'll have it. Even in the natural, I had this friend of mine, little guy, didn't have any big arms, didn't have any big muscles. And I'd watch him go and arm wrestle with people just, like the Hulk. And he just slammed them down every time. And I'm like, how do you do that, man? He's like, it's all in the head. In a human realm, people can grab a hold of a determination that just like, there's no way you can beat me. That's weird, eh? I'm telling you, it worked every time. It didn't matter how bulky the person was. Little old arm goes, slam! Well, if you could accomplish those kinds of things in a purely human and natural realm, what happens when you get out of your mind and into the mind of Christ? What happens when it isn't about metaphysics? It isn't about, your ability to do it through some kind of human mental power. But you're now by the Spirit of the Lord sold out. I mean, because I'm telling you right now, that's extreme focus. Just think about it. It's extreme focus. Think about it. If he lifts weights, he probably couldn't lift hardly anything, a fraction of what these other people did. Couldn't. Arm wrestling? Bang. A few seconds. There's none of that struggling back. Bang. Just down. Think about that. It's just because I think it's a great example for people to have to consider of what can be accomplished just within the human realm. We basically relegate ourselves to defeat and failure and all the terrible things in this life when God has promoted us over into being the recipients of a generous supply of everything that he has. And once again, there is nothing in my view of things more wonderful than being able to say to the sick, be healed. To say to those who are in prison, you set free now. To say that there's nothing more wonderful to me than seeing those who are mentally ill, schizophrenics, totally whacked out of their mind, totally insane. When we're in the foreign field, we see more totally mentally insane people healed than, if you took categories, we see more mentally insane people healed than any other category. Somebody says, well, why doesn't it happen here? Most of them are medicated. And they have a reason and an explanation for why they have what they have. And it's almost an impossibility to deal with. Give me somebody who has no reason. They're not fortified in some kind of, you know, belief system, human belief system. I'm telling you. I've watched a lot in my life in America. I've seen a lot of people with mental illness be healed instantaneously. But it can later on, but there's a lot of people that just gets convoluted. It's just so convoluted. This is what the doctor said. It's a chemical imbalance. It's something that's naturally explained. It's like when Jesus came to the disciples and they were attempting to cast the devil out of a young boy who often threw himself into the fire and into the water, and they weren't getting anywhere. And what they had was they had the Pharisees and the doctors of the law standing around them and giving them an explanation. Oh, this is happening to this guy right now because of the phase of the moon. Because that's what you would read it in your King James, King James as lunar struck. But literally what they would say, they had a doctrine that based upon the phase of the moon, people would have different responses. People still believe that today. You know? I mean, there's people that work in the ER and nurses say, oh, man, it's a full moon. Get ready. Because there's certain things that they see that gets a little weird, you know? Based upon their perception of things, whether it's truly been validated or not, who knoweth? I care not. You know? My department's over here is go set everybody free, take dominion over all of these things, praise the name of Jesus, to have authority over the wind and the wave. Who? Kamasai. The wind and the lake. Literally, it says the wind and the lake. Huh? Because actually it was a seismos or an earthquake. It wasn't a storm that particular time. And there was this great seismos or earthquake. And then as a result, the lake became turbulent with waves and a wind arose. And of course, we know that it was more than something natural because Jesus rebuked it. He dealt with the spirit of it. And everybody's going, what manner of man is this? And it doesn't say disciples in that verse. Actually, it's very unique. It says, and the men said, when they got into the boat, they were the disciples. In this event of doubt and unbelief, it says, literally, the men said, what manner of man is this? And it's very unveiling, very revealing of what happens. We become mere men under the elements, under the authority and the influences of the elements and the conditions around us. And Father doesn't want that. He wants us to be disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. He wants us to walk in the place of authority that he has given. But that's going to take some boldness and confidence and assurance. It's going to take some knowing him. It's going to take some absolute resolve
That's called faith. Believing that what he said he would do, he's going to do. You're sold out on it. You know what his will is. You know that this is what God demands. You know that it's available, and you're not willing to live without it. Let me say it again. You want to move, function, and operate in the gifts of the Spirit. You want to move, function, operate in the blessings of the Lord. You've got to know that it's Father's will. You've got to know that it's available, and you have to be unwilling to live without it. And then it's yours. How quickly? That quick. As soon as you believe that. As soon as you believe the three things I said, that quick. You're in. You're in. You're in. Now, whatever process you got to go through, just accept those three things. And whatever fights and battles, because it's going to be a fight and a battle. Because if you've lived your whole life being run by what you think, by your imagination, by your perception, being influenced and making decisions out of fear, insecurity, and manipulation, yeah. You do it and you don't even know it. It's just like a knee reflex. Ain't no way you can stop it. You bring the little rubber hammer, bang, knee goes up. Okay? And no way you can stop it. It's a reflex. You're not even conscious of it. That's just the way you function. That's the way you operate. God in his love has given us instruction to show us how to cut that stuff off. Hear me, people. It doesn't need to be a couple of anointed men and women running around doing all the work. It's God's, all God's people are called. It's just that most of God's people are stuck. And praise the Lord for your precious little hallelujahs and amens and showing up. We're glad you're here. God loves you. You know, your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. But we want some folks to grow up. It's time that more people participate in all this good thing that God has given us. And walking in the glory and the majesty. And where we really say, oh, God be magnified. And we understand what that means, Jesus being revealed in our life. And Jesus didn't have a music ministry. We think if we're in the music ministry, he's being magnified. Listen, Jesus being magnified in our life is Jesus, the same Jesus, doing the same things that he did 2,000 years ago right now. I mean, I love to tell the story because it so emphasizes that when we were in Nepal, we were transitioning on little airplanes and with some little airport that I'd never been in, and here comes running a guy, turns out to be a pastor, and he's hollering at me, Pastor Mark, Pastor Mark, Pastor Mark, and I turned around, I didn't know the guy, I didn't have any idea who he was. He says, you don't know me, but he said, I just got to tell you, he said, and he began to tell me about an Orthodox Hindu guy that they brought to the crusade who had been crippled most of his life, and he got healed in the crusade, and he was paralyzed from his waist down. His legs did not work. They were too skinny even to work. And in the crusade, he's up running around. He said to me, here's the point. He said, what happens is every Sunday, he just gets up and he walks around and a whole sermon is preached. Because that's Jesus being magnified. Here's a man that is an Orthodox Hindu that everybody knows is paralyzed from the waist down, and all he's got to do is get up and walk around and smile, and the gospel's being preached. That's the power of Jesus being magnified through healing, through signs, and through wonders. It's not through religion. It's not through philosophy. We live in a culture that's all about how smart you are, how many things you know. You know, how philosophical are you? How full of ideologies are you? Who do you believe God is? How tall is he? Where does he live? Describe heaven to me. I mean, come on, give me a break. The Lord wants to reveal heaven through us. He wants to reveal Jesus through us. He wants to reveal the Holy Ghost through us. And all these things that we're allowing on a daily basis, we're giving authority to them in our lives, are stopping us from the reality of heaven that has been freely given to anybody who will receive. And our biggest dynamic is just the whole things that we're allowing in our life. And that's why Matthew chapter 7 opens up, judge not out of human judgment. Don't you dare do it. You shut that stuff down. What's going to happen when you start taking note of it? You have no idea how much you do it till all of a sudden you decide you're not doing it anymore. And that's where I say you got to have to go get yourself some duct tape. Take a vow of silence. Vow of silence isn't so bad.
And then, you know, people start becoming aware. How many times did I just telling people how stuff right out of my own head had nothing to do with the judgments of the Lord? If it's not the judgment of the Lord, what is it? Human judgment by default. So then you start finding out how many times you're judging things, thinking things, saying things, have nothing to do with the reality of the Word of God, and you go, oh my goodness, bingo, eureka, I just discovered. Yeah, and eureka bad too, man. And you're not going to have place in my life anymore because eureka really bad. Yeah, and yes, yeah. And then all of a sudden, great progress of the things of the Spirit begin to happen. Not magically. Not because God suddenly decided to, as one guy said, well, if he's hearing, he certainly needs to wake up because he's sleeping. I said, no, Papa doesn't sleep. Oh, well, he's sleeping because he ain't listening to what I got to say. It has nothing to do with whether or not he's listening to what you got to say. It has everything to do as to whether or not you're listening to what he has to say. Because if you listen to what he has to say, he'll bring you out of living in a realm of doubt and unbelief and confusion and human misunderstanding into a realm of the divine, into a heavenly place where everything that he possesses becomes instantaneously, miraculously yours. You've already been born of the Holy Ghost, man. That means you're fully wide open and recipient and can understand, are able to fully understand everything that is freely given to us by God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the Lord's always doing the emphasis on the freely. I'm not earning nothing. Huh? Freely you receive, freely give. If I had to earn it, then I'm going to make everybody pay for it. It's just given to me. I got to step into a realm where, you know, and a lot of that has to do with our own self problems, our own self issues, our own self identity. And the Lord just says, I'll help you with that. You no longer live. And it's a good thing. It's an empowering thing. It's not a negative thing. He's like, this is another way of saying, forget you. I should put that in my translation. Forget you. Christ lives. Because that's really all. You know, people are all offended. But that's really what's going on. Forget you. You no longer live. Does that sound better? Oh, that's better. No. You dead. You don't exist. How do you like that? Is that a little bit better than forget you? Forget you means I don't count. No, you don't. Neither do I. Not in our own human self, because we can do nothing of ourselves when it comes to the things of the Spirit, when it comes to the things of heaven, when it comes to the things that really matter. We cannot do anything of ourselves. We don't count on that level. We can do nothing without him. And for me, that is not insultive. That's liberating. I don't want to do anything without him. I'm going to love him. I love him. Huh? I love him more than I love my wife. I don't want to do anything without her. I hope you're hearing me. I hope there's nobody getting all condemned right now and just feeling miserable like a failure. And you'd rather instead say, wait a minute, I'm getting this. I'm a slow learner, but I'm getting it. And it doesn't matter how slow of a learner you are. It's whether or not you ever get it. It's whether ever you whether you're going to really do it. Say, it's mine. The reason people step over into the occult so quickly, there's 30 million people practicing the most hideous interaction with demon spirits, releasing demon spirits upon men. 30 million voodoo people. There's a huge number that goes probably beyond statistics, black magic, which is another close, very close to voodoo. All kinds of witchcraft. They immediately go into it deep. Why? Because everything about the atmosphere and the human condition accommodates it. It's easy to do. It's already the flow. You just jump in and go. What God's calling us to do is completely opposite to what's going on in the atmosphere and opposite to the human condition. Ha ha. Hallelujah. And if you'll just go ahead, lay hold on this, God has given us supernatural, eternal, divine power to do this. Amen. To see what nobody else can see. to know what no one else but God knows, to do what only God can do, to reach into people and grab out of them addictions, to reach into their lives and command them to go free, to set them free, to break off every yoke. Huh. All we got to do is come over into the school of the Spirit and get it right and quit playing religious ideology games and quit mixing half God's word with half of our own ideology, half God's word with half of our perception, taking God's word and blending it with our own creative ideas. It ain't going to work, man. I know. I've tried. It ain't going to work. It's like, gong. Well, Lord, I'm trying this and I didn't get anywhere because it's too much you. I know a man of God, an older man of God, he said to me one time, he said this, he stepped into great signs, wonders, miracles ministry, and he said, the Lord told me, he said, if you'll always be happy, and you'll always be positive, and you'll always be gentle, because this is what God was calling him to do, I'll always reveal my miracle power through you. The hardest thing in this man's life was to be happy and to be positive. I had no problem with being gentle, but happy and positive. He never could deal with it. It was the giant too big. He constantly let his moodiness. Can you think about it? God gives him an anointing, a miracle anointing, signs, wonders anointing, takes him to the highest place in ministry in the United States of America, a platform of the world, and he can't defeat his own stinking moodiness and just keep himself happy in the Holy Ghost and stay positive. He's got to always just be in a rut of negativeness. There is no excuse for it. I don't care how many times your mama slapped you. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Think about, now, what about you? What about you? What about me? Have we individually allowed the spotlight of heaven to shine upon our soul to cause us to see this is what you're allowing to beset you, to stop you, to hold you back? You are allowing an influence, and it may be purely human. It may be purely, something that you could say is part of your endocrinology or part of, your basic, psychological disposition. In other words, your great-grandfather was negative, and your grandfather was negative, and your father was negative, and you ended up being negative too. Just genetically in you. And the Lord says, no, I'll give you the power now to be positive. I'll give you the power to put everything in a light of truth, in a light of good things. Don't look at the problem. In other words, always see the answer. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the hypostasis, a place to stand for those things that you're confident in. Huh? Well, he just wasn't able to, he wasn't willing to do it. He wasn't willing to put that discipline in his bit in his mouth as a discipline in his life, because if he would have stayed with it, you know what would have happened? He'd have broke through it in no time. What happens is this. We'll engage in something that's defeating us, that's hindering us, that's holding us back, some doubt, some unbelief, some fear, some condemnation, some accusation, some turmoil, something like that. And then all of a sudden, we give in and we let it go. And we're back in it. And then we waffle back and forth between it. Instead of standing and fighting through the thing. Now, okay, should you slip and you should fall into some whatever problem you're having, maybe fear or whatever it is, or intimidation or condemnation, immediately be willing to recognize it and stop it. Don't go with it. Because it becomes, as it were, a place that you can't get out of. It becomes a depression and can become an oppression. And I heard one man of God describe it like this. He said, it's like in your thinking, it's like a groove. And here, anytime you have thoughts going anywhere else, it slips right back into the groove. And you can't get out of the groove. I said, fill that bad boy in. Amen. Fill that groove in. Right now, fill that groove in Jesus' name. So that you're not just constantly going back to those same way of thinking. You have to stand up and recognize that the Lord has given you supernatural power. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty. They're God power. We got a divine ability to be able to deal with this thing. What's going to take place is you're going to recognize, wait a minute, I'm sitting here thinking in this fashion again, or I'm responding or reacting to these things again. I've got to shut it down. And you consistently give yourself to this purpose of stopping this wrong way of thinking, this wrong way of feeling by the Spirit of the Lord. And you're going to get a breakthrough, and it ain't going to have a power over you anymore. Go back with me to Matthew chapter 7 quickly. Now, here the Lord comes to emphasize this. And it's a powerful way of Him emphasizing how much He wants to give to us. And how He's set on giving to us and providing for us. So He says, what man is there? Is there even such a creature? What man is there of you? If his son would ask for a bread, you'd give him a stone. He's really emphasizing this thing. Yeah. You know, it's like going to Matthew chapter or Luke chapter 18 and learning why men ought to pray and not to faint by looking at the widow who comes to the judge who fears not God nor man. He cares nothing for man. Don't care about you. Don't care about God. But, you know, we see what's going to happen in the contrast. He's being compared to the one who loves everyone. And if we go ahead and just put that in the perspective of Jesus, who both fears God and fears man in that sense, or loves and honors and cherishes God and loves and honors and cherishes men. So you look at the extreme. So he's saying, what man would give his son a stone instead of a piece of bread? You're probably not going to find such a man. And he's saying, well, how much more am I going to give you what you asked me for? How much God pursues dealing with us to cause us to come into a great confidence and assurance and boldness and certainty. Why? Because it's going to take confidence and boldness and assurance and certainty for us to not be hindered by all this other stuff that's around you right now. You're going to have to size up your enemy, man, and get a big enough club to take them out. Come on now. I learned as a little guy, I don't care how big you are, there's a stick that's big enough. You're just going to have to size up the situation. I don't care how much foo you know. I'm going to show you right here what this stick knows. And I'm going to tell you that one of the most courage is going to stand, because I'm telling you right now, it's very hard to come after a stick. And somebody who's got a wild look in their eye swinging it. Yeah. Size up the problem. Size up your problem and get yourself a big enough stick to deal with it. Huh? Because what happens is people do not know their own weakness. A very successful man of God, When it wasn't long, I did only knew him for just a short period of time, and he started telling me a list of his weaknesses. Here's my weaknesses. First of all, I have a propensity towards being lazy. Probably the most full-out active person, running hard with the kingdom of God stuff that I know. He's got a weakness that he's numbered, laziness, and he makes sure he's got a stick big enough to whack it right upside the head. Now you listen to me. People sit around and say, well, I'm never measured. I've never taken account. You better take account of your life. You better find out what's hindering you, because it ain't God. Right. You better find out what's hindering you, because you ain't the devil. It's you and nothing but you. It's me and nothing but me. Jesus invalidated Satan's authority. Satan has no right to legislate authority. We give permission to everything that hinders us. You listen to me. You and I give permission to every hindrance, and it's time for us to recognize them, size them up, get a stick big enough to deal with it, and smash it. Hallelujah. Apokudanaya. Praise God. Amen. But if you just sit around, well, I don't know what's wrong with me. My dad was like this. Nothing's going to change. There's no pursuit. There's no pursuit. The asking's there, but there's no pursuit. When you're serious, you're going to find out. Like I kicked the chair. You're going to find out what's around here get hindering you, stopping you, what's in the way. It's out of here. Because God's will is settled forever in heaven. And I'm telling you right now, I'm not willing. People might be standing around me willing to let somebody be blind, willing to let somebody be sick, willing to let there be an atmosphere other than the glory of God, but not me. I'm going to find out what the problem is, and we're going to shake it down. Huh? If you had a rat in your house, I dare say any of you go to sleep if you knew you had a 2-3 foot rat in your house. And those things get big, huh? You would be up. You didn't have a shotgun, you'd go buy one. So you didn't have to get too close to that thing, huh? That you had a brave purse soul in the house and didn't mind using a baseball bat. Jesus. Come on, man. Let's get serious about the things of God. Let's get serious about the things that the rats that we allow run around that are they should be just as repulsive in our head and in our thinking and in our life. I mean, when you get serious about these things, man, I'm going to tell you right now, temptation becomes repulsive to you. All of a sudden, the appetites of the demonic no longer are going to have place to elicit these effects on your body. Because you're too caught up in the good things of heaven. If sin was so good, God would have done it. He ain't done any of it. Because it's evil, it's bad, everything, and it's time people get wisdom. And then, of course, when you do, what do? You resist it. You won't allow it. You get after the thing. Huh? Well, let's go ahead and now turn this thing around in a positive sense. Okay? Let's get after what Father has freely given. Huh? Instead of getting after running off something we're not supposed to have, running off something that's trying to impose itself on us, that's going to hurt us. So the Lord says to us, if you have a fish, we give him a serpent. Boy, that's pretty radical. Somebody said, it's an eel. No, it's a serpent. It wouldn't be so bad eating an eel. There's people who eat eels. And I hear that they're actually can be made to taste very good. And I wouldn't doubt it. But we're talking about a full-on viper, you know. Ugly one. Some people eat rattlesnake. I don't believe that's good. Everybody says, well, I'm not going to get into that. The Lord emphasized, if you then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, to your sons. And literally, it's to your sons, I believe here. How much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask? And, of course, when you look over in Luke chapter 11, he is going to say, just go look at Luke chapter 11 real quick. Just turn over to Luke chapter 11 because it's a corollary verse of Scripture to this. Of course, it's a different sermon. But nonetheless, it's the same. Jesus basically preaching the same message. He says, verse 13, if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts, good doma, gifts, doma, which actually primarily is a word reserved for supernatural gifts of the Spirit. Okay? Unlike other kairos, graces, or gifts that could be relegated to food and other kinds of natural blessings, these are doma is usually something that's supernatural. And so here we say, and we get it really here in verse 13, he says, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Ghost to them who ask? And so when you go back over here, the doma, the give good gifts, he's really putting at the center of it the Holy Ghost. And somebody says, oh, well, see, it's just spiritual. Wait a minute. The Holy Ghost is the one who does all of the miracles, every dimension of miracles, provision miracles, healing miracles. It doesn't matter what miracle it is. He's the one who produces out of the unseen that which becomes something that we can use. It's a valuable, meaningful to us. Now, here's a very important point I want to get across to you. because it's another dimension of hindrance. It's another thing that gets in people's way. Back in Matthew chapter 7, verse 12. This isn't just, how did that get in there? This is, doesn't fit. No, all the verses of Scripture fit in the context. You just got to have a little bit of understanding how they fit. The Lord, they go right along with the first introduction of don't judging other people after your own judgment. Don't go speck hunting when you're a logger, on and on. Huh? Yeah. He says, what you want people to do to you? Now, you're asking me, and I'm going to give you anything you want. Now, you know, you go, you treat everybody like you want to be treated. Huh? You make sure you're taking care of people around you. You make sure you're treating people right. Therefore, all things, whatever you would that men should do to you, do even to them. And in doing so, you're fulfilling all the law and the prophets. So see, I've got insight to this now, because I know that divine love is that which fulfills all the law and the prophets. So then the Lord now categorically helps me to understand that a dimension of divine love is that I'm going to go out there and I'm going to start taking care of people and doing unto them just like I would want them to do unto me. That Father's saying, listen, once again, your relationship with people around you, how you're connecting with them, how you're interacting with them, is going to have a giant impact on what you're going to be able to receive. I'm giving it, but there's all these things running hindrance. I said, anoint Joshua, son of Josedek, but Satan's standing there to hinder him. I sent 21 days ago the answer, you highly beloved Daniel of the Lord. 21 days ago, the answer was already sent. Immediately you asked, the answer was sent, but there was hindrances stopping us. There were the powers of darkness in that case stopping us. Huh? And Gabriel said, Michael came to help me. And he's out there holding them off right now so I can come on. That's basically what he said. He's out there holding them off right now so I can get up here and tell you the answer to your prayer. The Lord's dealing with the things that are hindering us. Behaviors, attitudes, dispositions, unholy things, things of doubt, things of unbelief, things of fear. Listen, fear has more to do with stopping the supply of the things of the Spirit to our life than anything else. And praise God, perfect love casts out all fear, and perfect love comes right to us from the Holy Ghost, and we're going to have to learn how to get in it and stay in it and live in it, think in it, act in it, move in it. Hallelujah. Recognize all the times throughout the days that we're willing to be without it, and all the processes of thoughts and attitudes that come because we're willing to be without its strong influence. And to be without a strong influence is to be without the strong influence of the Holy Ghost, to be without the rulership of the Holy Ghost. If we'll just get this down, pare down real simple, people, you'll immediately find yourself soaring in the things that God has freely given to us in the authority of Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, it's just that simple. And I want you to look at this again. I want you to look at now, go back with me to Mark, and I want you to look at it in Mark as well, in Mark chapter 11. Excuse me. Mark chapter 11, back to verse 24. He says, listen, whatever thing you desire, want anything you want. And Father's a good father. Yes. You know what? Daniel's a good son. Ruth's a good daughter. Daniel's, but I'm going to give an application here because Daniel's working with me, helping me do a lot of things that I'm doing. Anything Daniel wants, I'll give it to him. Anything. I'll do whatever it takes. He asked me, Dad, I need this. I'll make sure it happens. It's going to happen. Listen, take that times heaven. That's what Father's going to be doing for us. Whatever you desire. I'm not going to ask him, are you sure you need that? I'm going to say, Dad, could you get this for me? I'm going to get it. I'm going to make it happen. And think about Father. For you. Not for me, for you. Huh? You being convinced the Father's going to do it for me ain't going to do you a bit of good. He said, I'm sure the Father's going to, like Preacher came to me and said, I'm sure you're making heaven. I'm sure you're going to heaven. You know, I wanted to say, are you sure you're going to heaven? Because the bottom line of it is, you can believe the best things for me, and it ain't going to do you any good till you start believing it for you. Hallelujah. You can go around telling everybody that Jesus loves them, died for them at Calvary, but you're going to have to believe that he loves you too and died for you at Calvary. And there's going to be a lot of liberty. Didn't know and believe the love that God has for you. God is love. I mean, this is where it's all happening. I mean, this is everything that we need to know and believe the love that God has for us, for God is love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. That place of dwelling in him, in that realm of his love, is where we now have boldness and confidence and that whatever we ask, right? That's 1 John 3:22, that whatever we ask, he's going to do it. Huh? Why? Because we're partners with him. We do what he says. We love him and we do what he says. We're in relationship with him. I want you to step over in this realm. I want you to, you look, when you get this, you can say that you can think that you know it. When you can do it, you know it. Until you can do it, you don't know it. You may have a concept of it, but until you can do it, you know, it's like watching the teacher put the math, solve the math problem on the chalkboard, and you go, that's easy, I can do that. I followed the whole thing. Huh? And then you don't even do anything with it. Oh, that's simple. And then you go sit down and take the test, and it's like, huh? You're going backwards, not forwards. No, until you do it, you can't. Until you do it, until you can do it, until you can take this and use it, you don't really know it. Well, good news is that the Lord's come to show us in such a way so we can know it. You know how he's going to show us? In the context of the love, to know the love of Christ that passes knowledge, something you can't understand rationally and figure it out through your own experience. And out of that, then comes the expression of every dimension, the fullness of God. So I'm there. I'm going to have it. I'm going to lay hold on it. I'm not going to be so arrogant and stupid to think, well, I got this. I understand this. I know this. You know, I don't know what God's problem is. No. What's best to do is to say, you know, I get it. I hear it. I believe it. I want it, but I don't know how to do it. Father, show me how to do this. I want to have this in my life. I can see it from afar off, but it's not a practical application. I don't know how it works. I could see it afar off, but it's not a practical application. I don't know how to do it. I don't know how to keep condemnation out of my head, keep fear out of my life, keep accusations. I don't know how to show this kind of love. I had a person on the phone talking to me the other day and just saying this thing, that thing, the other thing. I said, well, look, if you want that anointing that you have to flow out of you, you have to have compassion and love for people, because the anointing will flow out of you as much compassion and love you have for people. And not everybody's going to receive it. But if you, whatever God's placed on you in the inside of you, it will come out of you through your cooperation with love and compassion. That's by the Holy Ghost, not natural love and compassion, as it were. So back over to this verse of scripture here, Mark chapter 11. Verse 25. And while you're standing there asking whatever you desire, here it is. Relationship problems. If you want to step into this realm, if you want to have all these things that I'm willing to give you, you make sure that you're taking care of everybody around you. And you're loving them. And you're doing them like you want everyone to do to you. You asking, you're standing over in this relationship dynamic of where I called you and purposed you to come and want this to freely flow to you. Listen, I'm going to tell you something else going to hinder you. If you've got unforgiveness at all, you ain't getting nothing. You're not getting nothing. Just look here. And when you stand there asking whatever you desire, forgive. You better forgive. It'll hinder you as much as a lion will hinder you. All liars shall have their part in the lake of fire, right? So what are you going to do about that? You're going to resolve yourself not to tell a lie. How many of you can live a day without lying? I would certainly hope so we could live a day without lying. I would hate that we're not going to
Maybe. I think so, yeah. Because we want to be further down the road than that. We want to make sure that that stuff of the former conversation been completely put away and lie not one to another. But you resolve yourself to do that, you're going to be able to do this. You're going to be able to set boundaries for yourself. You're going to be able to put place things in place in your life where that you're not going to be lying to people around you. And it's going to become so important to you that if you do lie to somebody, you're going to be, you know, you're not going to sleep at night kind of thing until you get it right. Well, this is the same way the rest of these things work. It just got to become important to you. It's just got to become valuable to you. It's got to become meaningful to you. You got to really believe that this stuff will hinder you. You got to believe that unforgiveness, just like lying, is going to keep you from the provision and blessings of God. I mean, my goodness gracious, when you recognize that whatever measure you give out, that's the measure that's going to come back to you. And Father puts it in context there in Matthew chapter 5. Matthew 5 builds to Matthew 6 to Matthew 7. It's just a beautiful, trilogy of ministry and growth in the Spirit when you understand. That's why I say so many times people grab Matthew 5, 6, and 7, their whole lives will be changed. Changed my life. Jesus ministered it to change everybody's life. So, just get back here quickly to this. If you stand praying, forgive. The Lord said, if you don't forgive, neither shall be forgiven you. If you don't forgive men from your heart, it's not going to be forgiven you. With whatever measure of mercy you give to people, as a measure, it's coming back to you. Huh? And you can go ahead and throw in, shake down, press together, and running over. I mean, we don't want to put that on the negative side. We just want to put that on the positive side. Well, just put it on the positive side. Just walk around in a bunch of mercy and forgiving everybody. Yeah. Easy forgiving. Just you would have to practice that. What if you spend a lifetime of holding grudges? You're gonna have a hard time breaking through that fortified fortress. You're gonna have a hard. Give creation to a massive army that you empowered to dominate and rule over your life, and now you got to break through that. Think about it, dear people. Don't start building up strongholds for yourself. Don't start giving yourself to depression. You know, I believe the Lord's going to actually have me start ministering some, because it keeps coming back to me the past three times I've ministered. And on the difference, because the Lord Jesus lays out in even in one verse of Scripture the difference between depression and oppression. And God's people can come into depression. God's people can be born again, and just like they can backslide and start having all kinds of ungodliness in their life, they can allow depression on the level of demon spirit activity, depressing their mind, controlling and ruling their mind, and having various different results, behavioral results, emotional results. And then it comes to oppression. And that's demon activity in the life of someone going to church. Now what happens, what gets really bad, is when demon activity is going on in people's lives, and they just say, well, I'm saved, and they won't recognize it. They just won't listen to it. And so that's why they won't listen to reason. So that's why Derek Prince and Don Bashan and others came and just, instead of telling people, look, you backslid, you know, they just came and said, look, you're being harassed by demon spirits, and we're here to walk you through inner healing. And what the Lord did with it is at least people are now going to voluntarily give themselves to at least thinking for a moment that there may be something wrong with their relationship with the Lord Jesus. Because you get people stuck in deception and religion, and you can't even bring them to a place of recognizing that there's some problem with their relationship with the Lord Jesus. Don't matter how many biblical proofs you put in front of them. Don't matter how much you describe the fruits and attributes of the Holy Ghost and influence of the Spirit of God. They still convince themselves of a lie. And don't do that. Don't keep your heart tender. I just keep my heart tender before the Lord. And it's easy to keep your heart tender before the Lord when you engage in the things of the Spirit. when you're going after seeing people healed of sickness and diseases, and you're going after fellowship in the Holy Ghost, and you love joy. I love joy. I love being happy. I love peace. I love love. And I was just yesterday, you know, just crying out to God, Lord, show me how to walk in a greater dimension of love. I mean, because what happens is we'll walk with God, and then we'll have an encounter with Him, and we'll see the glory of His love. And in the light of the glory of His love, we'll begin to see our harshness and our hardness. Huh? And then what does that always do? Always results. Lord, let a greater dimension of servitude be in my life. And you know what always happens in the greater dimension of love? It's easier to forgive. It's easier to show mercy. And sometimes, like, it's when we go to greater levels of persecution, I found this, where now I've had a greater level of persecution. I've had people say things about me that are even so wild and out there and so disconnected from anything that is real. And then it be someone who is even that much closer to me, because if it's somebody far distant from you, it doesn't matter. You don't really know. It doesn't really even matter, you know. But now it's somebody like a Judas, somebody get real close to you, you know, and does that. What happens now? Uh-oh. Now you're dealing with, oh, God, I'm forgiving them, but it's keep coming back. Yeah, they should have done that to me. I can't believe they did that to me, right? You know that? Oh, Lord, I forgive them. But then and you're saying, Lord, why isn't this flowing like it does everywhere else? And then the Lord lets you see a glimpse of His love. Then all what happens is you respond and go, oh, God, Father, I'm so in need of walking in Your love and Your compassion. Then He gives that to you. He gives, and you find yourself now walking in a greater dimension of love and compassion. And then what happens is now you can forgive that person that before you were still having, you're still coming back to you, because now you have a greater capacity to deal with more intense, more insultive, more hurtful displays of persecution or injustice or wrongdoing or offense. You see what I'm saying? There's just always this growing and maturing. It's wonderful. It's a great adventure to be on. Don't miss out. Don't just put things in neutral and coast down the hill, because I'm telling you right now, there ain't nothing down there at the bottom that you want. I love this. I love just meditating here. See, I just meditate here, and I just say, here's what I do. I go, well, Lord, I don't want any of that in my life. Lord, I don't want 25 in my life. I don't want any bad parts of 25 and 26 in my life. I only want 24. I just say, I don't say, oh, I can do that. Oh, I can do that. Don't do that. That ain't going to work. Because you can't do nothing of yourself. I just say, Lord, I want that capacity to make sure that I'm doing it. Father, am I doing that good? Lord, show me where I'm doing it, not doing it well. Then He'll give you an opportunity. Somebody real close to you come and say all kind of bad things about you, and you say, how are you doing now? You asked me to show you. There's not much giggling going on right now. The most needful thing in your life. And I hope that you can grab it. I hope that you're really grabbing it. Because it is. When you stand praying, forgive if any man ought against you, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive you or your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive you of your trespasses. In the context of all that He wants to give us, things have got to be right. He gives us anything we desire, anything we want, but things got to be right. Somebody said, well, I asked and didn't receive. Things weren't right. And I could tell you about 10 to 15 different dimensions of where they were wrong, which I've gone over tonight, and you can go and count them up. Go review the YouTube. Because I'm telling you, you do what I'm talking about. You give yourself to these things that we just described, you're going to be successful in things of spirit. You're going to grow and you're going to mature in the things of God. Hallelujah. Sikando borasada. Sibirinea. Telemosa kingalaya. Hallelujah. He prasutane yeshaya. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Let me just say this. When you feel bad about yourself, get right over to feeling good about yourself.
Somebody said, I don't do that. Start feeling good about what Jesus has done for you. Just put it out. If you start feeling bad about yourself, you need to repent for something, repent. Be good. Be washed. Ha. Be cleansed. Hallelujah. Be accepted in the Beloved. Live your life being accepted in the Beloved. Live your life under the rule of Philippians 4:8. Just do it. It's going to be hard. It's going to be hard. Are you with me?
Yes.
Whatsoever thing is true, whatsoever thing is pure, whatsoever thing is honest, whatsoever thing is righteous, whatsoever thing is pure, whatsoever thing is lovely, whatsoever thing has what if it has any virtue to it, whatsoever is virtuous, just the virtuous stuff, whatsoever is praiseworthy, just think of these things. Block out everything else. Don't look for specks. Anything else is specks. And it immediately manifests that you got a log. And then you're going to hear Jesus say, you hypocrite. That's what he's going to say. This is ugly. This ain't good. This isn't like the sweet, huggy, whatever you want. I'm giving it to you. You're my son. I'm your father. It's hypocrite. First remove the log out of your own eye so that you may see to remove the speck out of your brother's eye. Because once you no longer have a log, you're not going to see any specks. Now, the question isn't whether or not God is going to do all these things for you. That's settled. The question is whether or not you're going to do these things that God told you to do. Are you going to do Philippians 4:8 from here on out? Are you going to give yourself over to these responses that the Lord has described? That's what's at issue here. That's it. Are you going to allow fear to torment you? Are you going to allow condemnation? Are you going to allow offenses? Are you going to allow hurts and unforgiveness? And the correct answer is, by the help and the strength of the Lord, by the Spirit of the Lord and the power of His might, by the working power of Jesus Christ in my life, because I can't do anything. Hallelujah. You know, I've given myself to forgiving people. I've given myself to mercy. And because I've given myself to forgiving and to mercy, it just flows. But if I start saying, I'm really good at this, I'm going to get a rebuke from the Holy Ghost, and He's going to say, no, I'm good at this, and you allowing me to be good at it. So you better get this thing right. You're going to have to give yourself to allowing God, the Holy Ghost, to establish you in all these good things. Hallelujah. I'm just now beginning to really catch on. I'm a slow learner. And I'm believing that God's going to make me a fast learner. I believe that you get the breakthrough. It's like suddenly, you know, you're kind of like, you're a late bloomer. You know, kind of thing. It's like you're sitting in the class lost most of the time. Then all of a sudden, click, it hits, and then you just fly with it. You just start excelling. And that's how I am in a lot of ways in the things of the Spirit. And I'm laying hold on, moving into this realm in obedience to the Lord. And I pray that you also will with me. Just say, okay, I'm going to give all attendance then to making my calling and election sure. And so my calling and my election is to fully represent Jesus. Hallelujah. For rapid progress and growth. I was going to tell you something. Well, I'm going to go ahead and tell it to you. Kind of just waiting, you know, whether I should. But you know, the Lord said, I want to show you the future with great clarity. Come, I want to teach you about holiness. And you know that, and that was like 6 years ago, 7 years ago. And I'm like, Lord, I know about holiness. I wrote a commentary on the book of Leviticus. I was raised in the holiness movement. I'm just now starting to get what the Lord was saying to me. But praise God, I'm getting it. I say, okay. I see the connection. Go ahead. You look good back there. That's good that you're up there. See her. See Crystal? Anointing's increasing in her life. You know what she had to break through? Intimidation. Am I right? Am I wrong? Am I right? Am I wrong? Am I wrong? Just, I'm right. Let's do this thing, okay? The halting between two opinions. I want boldness now. I'm tired of being stopped by my fear. The Lord says, don't halt between two opinions. You're not going to get anything from me if you halt between two opinions. Don't be double-minded. Don't stagger. Set yourself and let's do this thing. And whatever you ask Papa, right? He gives liberally. Does his father gives sparingly? Stand with me, everybody. He gives liberally. So, what do you want? What do you want? Just think about what do you want? What do you want? What do you want? One day the Lord spoke to me and said, I want you to go and visit certain people. I'm going to tell you certain people I want you to go visit. I said, okay, God, now that sounds good. I'll do that. I'll go visit people. And I said, Lord, give me people to go visit. And I said, I'll be on the way driving there. You know, I know the Lord told me to go visit them. Oh, God, speak through me. Lord, you know I'm not really good at small talk. Help me. If I need to do small talk, help me. Weather stuff. And I don't know anything about sports, so. You know, because I'm like, Lord, I don't know how to do that. I don't really know how to do living room chit-chat. Help me. Help me, Papa. Speak through me. I'm driving over, you know. You know, and then you get the comfort of the Holy Ghost. Manifest presence. You know what the manifest presence is? I got you covered. You might as well just go ahead and manifest presence. We're good. I don't even have to ask anymore. And it's a greater than manifest. It's the thicker manifest presence, really what I'm saying. And I'd always walk in every person's house that the Lord sent me to during that time period. I'd walk in the house, and the first thing the Holy Ghost would say out of my mouth, what is it that you want God to do? What do you want? Ask him whatever you want. Ask him, what do you want? Majority of time, there's a couple of exceptions. What do you want? And I'm asking you tonight. In Christ's stead, and the one who loves you so much, he gave up his life for you. He counted your life more dear to himself than his own life. I'm asking you in Father's place, the one who loved you so much, he spared no expense to have a relationship with you tonight. The one who's so dedicated to giving you the things that you have need of. I'm coming to you and I'm asking you, what would you like? What do you want? I was watching a commercial. Okay, I can't remember. Shriners, I think it's Shriners Hospital. The little guy sitting there in a wheelchair asking for Shriner donations, Shriners. And I look at that stuff and I just get all busted up. I want to crawl on TV and pull him out of the wheelchair. That's what I want. See, you know where I got that from? God put it in me. That's who I'm supposed to be. That's what I'm supposed to do. I'm signs, wonders, a miracle person called by the Lord Jesus Christ to do the works of Jesus. I don't believe that anybody's exempt from that. But you got to let God develop that in your heart. You got to let God make that real to you. All you and I have to do is not be willing to stop. I haven't stopped. Thank you, Jesus. And that's just goodness of God. 32 years ago, Margaret's been around a long time. We're so blessed that she's been around. 32 years ago, Margaret had a chronic disease of asthma, and just told her she didn't have to have that anymore, and she was immediately healed. I haven't stopped. There's been a lot of stuff that comes at me right, left, and center. I have had things that didn't work out like I thought they were. Because, I mean, when I began to reach into a battle to take a hold of the financial kingdom. Boy, I didn't realize what I was up against, but I haven't stopped. I'm going after every dimension. I'm not going after just one thing. I'm going after everything. I know God says this is it. This is ours. He wants us to do these things, to have these things, to be these things. I'm going to stop. So I prayed for people, and they didn't get healed. And then they talked bad about me. Said, oh, he thinks he's really something special. I went up there, and I didn't get healed. I'm not going to stop. Because I'm not living by my word, I'm living by His word. I want you to live by His word, not your word. I want you to think His ideas, not your ideas. I want you to have His perceptions, not your perception. If something looks like it's in the way, just run harder. Go faster. Lay hold on it that much more. You know, just looking at your shirt, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, is based on Philippians 4:8. Once again, there's the place, there's the opportunity, there's the glory realm, but there's a disposition. The Spirit of the Lord gave me a word, put a word in my mouth about 2 months ago, that the disposition of your life will result in the position in Him. That disposition will ultimately result in where you find yourself functioning in the things of the Spirit. Got to do it Father's way, and I got to work any other way. Guesses. Second guesses, feelings, let everything be proved. Prove everything. Prove everything first and foremost by the Word of God, in the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses by the Word of God. Amen. Just live this way. Well, just waiting on the Lord, you know, just Father wanted me to do anything here in terms of praying for people. Just standing here, just waiting on the Holy Ghost. We don't do anything out of our own thinking, out of our own mind. Here's what we do know is this. We know that this, listen, we know that if you're sick, you can call for the elders of the church. They'll anoint you with oil, and you'll be healed. Amen. And once again, we'll hear it. We'll hear it, won't we? Confess your sins and pray over them, huh? Yeah, there will be a condition in there. Can't be harboring anything going on secret. Can't be bottling it up, burying it. So, Lord, I'm asking you, Father, in your mercy, cause the floodlight of heaven shine upon our soul. And let us see tonight by the Spirit of wisdom and revelation the things, Lord, that have, as it were, operated in the shadows in our life, in the area of the unconscious. You know, for me, in a lot of respects, the word of knowledge works in my life and people, towards people, to help them understand things they're not conscious of. Try that on for size. To convince somebody of something they're not conscious of. You just got to trust them. Because I'm going to be declaring to you something you're not conscious of. You're going, what? Yeah, well, this is what the Lord says. If you'll just do this. Boy, you've really got to really have a place of,
of confidence and trust and security in Christ Jesus. And of course, the Lord makes it real too, you know. You're not going to be absent for too long of it, because then you're going to come, and going to be too long, you're going to go, wow, I see now. But I'm just asking, you know, because, and I say that because I asked the Lord, I said to him, I said, Lord, shine a floodlight on your heaven, from heaven upon our hearts, cause us to see those things operating in the shadows, things that we're not conscious of. And the Lord just reminded me. He goes, oh, well, I do that. But what do you do with it? So when we ask the Lord, many times he's going to speak through that which he has put in the church. Apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. He's going to speak through the gifts, the doma. Huh? So you ask the Father, and he's going to give you doma. Well, you thought it was going to be something different than a pastor, and he doesn't give you a pastor. You got to be kidding. This is what I get? No, that pastor's going to perfect you. If that pastor functions in the Holy Ghost, he's going to be my hand of perfection upon your life. He's going to build up the church. See, I believe this. That's why I'm given to it. I believe that God's gifting is the only means by which the church can be the church. And we've got to do it his way. And we just got to keep speaking. We just keep speaking to the mountain. We just keep speaking to whatever the hindrances are, whatever the problems are, whatever the issues are. Because you can have all kinds of spec hunting and all kinds of ways you would do it different, but let's see what you do when you get up here. Let's see what happens when you now are responsible for the flow of God, the move of God, huh? When you're responsible for declaring the Word of God, all of a sudden all your criticism and all your spec finding and all your ideas have just been totally forsaken. They've been abandoned. They ain't working for you. It's easy to sit in the nosebleed section and tell the quarterback what he's doing wrong. Yeah, it is. Watch out. Careful with yourself. It'll keep you from flowing in God. It'll keep you from moving in the things the Spirit of the Lord has given you opportunity to have. You got to take your old brain and just put it in a big old, you know, minus 10 Kelvin, completely shut down, minus 273 degrees Celsius. Shut her down. Somebody said, well, how do I do that? Can you tell me how to do that? I'll tell you how to do it. Come up against the imaginations. Stop the speculation. Bring an end to the fear and accusation. Running against God and against you. Usually it's just pointed at you, but it's really against God. Pointed against you because if you believe what God says concerning his son, you won't have that. So really then it's by virtue of that, it is directed against God. You see that? Kind of ricochet. Hear that? Listen to me. Probably no man can control their thoughts. Probably no man. Really? So God's given us God power. Do you know how to take hold of God power? Then that's where it's firstly going to be applied. Hallelujah. How do you know you need to act? How do you know you need to submit? The Word of God gives you instruction, tells you this is what you're supposed to be acting, this is what you're supposed to be thinking, this is what you're supposed to be doing. And you go, I want to do that. Then that's the light into my path. Shows me, wait a minute, no, you're not doing what God told you to do. You're allowing something God hasn't said. The Word of God reveals. The Word of God makes known. So tonight, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I pray that every one of you take heed unto the Word of God. Take heed unto the Word of life. And recognize the anointing of the Holy Ghost and the power that has been given to you so that you can do what's right in the eyes of the living God, so that you can begin to obey the laws of the Spirit of life that are in Christ Jesus, so that you can begin to cooperate with God in such a way that the hindrance cannot stop you no more. that the things that would run interference with God's supply will not be able to be effective against your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bodostaya. In Jesus' name. Bodostaya. In Jesus. Pasitina asitayate. Pokutukiyanakata. Pokayinakitapayanasi. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we speak change in this place tonight. Father, I ask you to strengthen every person in here by your Spirit, every person, every single one. Lord, no matter how long they've been walking with you, no matter how strong or how weak or how much knowledge or how much lack of knowledge, doesn't matter. It's irrelevant to fathers. He just wants to touch you. He wants to strengthen you. Doesn't matter how many things you've been through or how many things you haven't been through or how old you are, how young you are. Doesn't matter. God, the Holy Ghost, wants to strengthen you. He wants to show you the right way. If you just take heed unto His Word, if you just meditate on His Word day and night, you'll have good success. If you just say, okay, God, I'm going to do it your way. I'm not allowing anything else by your help and your grace, by your strength, by your power. Father, I thank you for your blessing upon this church called the Abiding Place Ministry. And every lie, and every accusation, and every false word, and every false thing, and every curse, and everything that belongs to the camp of the enemy, I bust its power right now. I render those things ineffective. Those lies, I render them ineffective. Father, I thank you that in your love and in your mercy and your dedication to your church and glorifying your name, Lord, that you begin to work even in the weakest frame. That you begin to show those, oh Lord, who seem to be even maybe furthest away, how easy this is to obey, to function with you, to operate with you, to flow in you. Father, I pray tonight that every soul in this place with total abandonment resolves themselves to solely following you, resigns themselves to only allowing you to live from here on out, to have no other value or meaning for their life except for the representation of heaven, of living in this glory realm, of interacting with the Holy Ghost, of being found in this place called the Spirit, where there is no condemnation. Hallelujah. Amen. As a free gift, Father has given to you the baptism in His presence. Hallelujah. Don't be without it. As a free gift, He's given you the glory of His own presence, both with you and in you, that you the habitation of the Lord. Don't forget. Don't forget. Don't forget. Do not forget. Do not let these things slip. In the name of Jesus. Listen, what I want you to do tonight is I want you to get an offering ready. You just want to always worship God with an offering. Never want to come to church without an offering. Somebody said, going to church costs me. Every time I go to church, it costs me. No. No, you gain. No, when you do it right and you move in faith, it gets multiplied. Because that's what Father said. Now I know all the logic and all the reasoning to say otherwise. Say, no, you without. You gave it, and you now without it. The Lord said, you give, I'll multiply it. He said, He's multiplying. Even if you give liberally, He's going to still multiply it. You're going to get a harvest, a liberal harvest. If you give sparingly, you're going to get a sparing harvest. You give liberally, you give a liberal harvest. Either way, He's still multiplying it. Huh? And it's the honor and the act of the heart and the surrender of the heart. They're always going to worship God. Don't come before His presence empty-handed. Don't ever do it. Don't ever do it. Find something. Borrow something. Tell somebody you're paying back in the millennium. Whatever you need to do. Remind them of the verse of Scripture that says, if your brother ask of you, withhold not. No. Give. Listen. just whatever it takes, just resolve yourself to give and continue to give. Because if you're not willing to give, it's going to stop you from moving forward. If you're not willing to give, your father's not willing to give. If you're going to withhold, your father's going to withhold. For without ever measure you give out is going to be measured to you again. You don't want those kinds of things. You want generosity. You want faith on every area. Every area that hits you with doubt. Every area that hits you with fear, unbelief. Every area that hits you with self-preservation. Meet it head on and don't give place to it. Don't give place to it. I mean, it's like, one man of God said, you know, if I feel intimidated about giving, feel like I can't give, when I think of something I'm supposed to give or just lay a figure out there before the Lord, then what I do is I go ahead and double it till the enemy quits hassling me, till fear quits messing with me. Huh? Why don't you try that? You know, in other words, if you feel like, you know, want to just feel like the Lord would have me just give $100 offering tonight, and then you hit with fear, mind if I give $100 offering, well, that's going to impact us. We're going to be broke down on the side of the road. We'll run out of gas. Then just go ahead and up it to $200 until the fear shuts down. Do it in every dimension of your life. Start in every dimension of your life, because if you don't, you're going to be held back. You'll come to me, you're 80 years old. I don't know what's wrong with me. Well, I've been trying to tell you for the past 60 years. Give. Then I'm just trying to tell you just very practical things. You dealing with issues in your life. You dealing with fears. You dealing with threats. You dealing with doubt. You dealing with unbelief. You dealing with wrong behavior, wrong manner of thinking. Hallelujah. Boy, I feel the anointing. Boy, I feel the miracle. Kasate aranahase. Who? Harabosate eka. Who? I feel release. Prosane. I feel release. I feel divine provision. I feel wealth. I feel riches right here, right now. Because in his presence is wealth and riches. Hallelujah. In his presence is honor and wealth and power. Hallelujah. Come live over here in this place. Things that he'll give to you. Things that he'll miraculously supply. Hallelujah. Amen. Margaret, Brad, Margaret and family came out serving in the ministry. Okay. And basically, serving on MTC, basically the Lord just gave him a ranch. You know, just gave him wealth. Just gave this. Here, have this. You can never outgive God. You can't go and serve with abandonment and not get a reward. I mean, I just went out and served with abandonment. I said, listen, you know what? We're going to give you $500 a month. That's nothing. Okay, that's fine. They're like, okay, good. Praise God. We owe him a little bit of money.
We never went without.
But you never went without. God's always providing.
Over and abundant.
But most of the time we were able to be there with it. But look at what Papa did. Huh? Is it good?
So good.
That's my experience. That's everybody's experience in the Bible. And that's everybody's experience that ever did it. Someone said to a guy that I know, how is it that you have so much wealth? He said, well, it's because I just do total abandonment, give. And I watched him in his life, and he was given by a royal group in, I think it was in Hungary, part of the royal jewels that belonged to the royal family. And he gives everything away. He just constantly gives everything away. And he's one night, and I'm in a meeting with him, and I saw him moving his ring, and I'm going, oh, don't give that away. Please, man, don't. I'm thinking and praying, oh, Lord, please. I knew what was going to happen. I mean, here's something that is like you talk about rare upon rare upon rare to have. Something of an heirloom of royalty that dated back to the 11th century or something like that. It was wild. He takes it off and he goes over to another preacher and he puts it on his hand. Total abandonment. Huh? What things that you have do you hold on to? What is it that Father asked of you, you wouldn't give it? You have to think about this. For me, he's got it all. He can have it all. I want nothing. I just want him. I just want him. And that's the way the true riches are. Because if you don't know how to do this, he can't give you the true riches. Because you won't give them away liberally. You won't just give it. You'll hold on to it. The same thing that happens to you with mammon. That's why the Lord says that if you can't be trusted with earthly riches, who can give you the true riches? If you're not going to give, just continually give. And who's most important to give? Father. Things of the kingdom. Things of the spirit. That's what he says. People that allow all kinds of imaginations and ideas run interference with it. All that's irrelevant. It's what Father said. Somebody said, where's the money going? We're going to burn it. It's an offering. It's burnt. Doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. It's irrelevant. Totally irrelevant. Father didn't say nothing about that part. I want you to grab hold of this thing. I want you to generously, lavishly pouring it out. Don't hold on to anything. Father wants to generously give to you. And he's going to generously give to you based upon how you give. With what measure you give, it should be measured to you again. With what measure you give out. With the way that you let go of that which Father has supplied to you. What do you have that God did not give you? Keep that. Whatever you have that God didn't give you, go ahead, you keep it. I want you to do inventory. Anything that God gave you, it belongs to him. It's his. That's now you can live with total abandonment. Just as a steward. Hallelujah. And see, this really does encapsulate the meeting tonight because it goes right to the heart of the matter. It goes right to the stingy issues that lie in the shadows. It's true. Just live with abandonment. And watch what Father does. Can never outgive God. He's a generous God. He's not telling you to give because he wants you to end up in the poorhouse with nothing. He's telling you to give because he wants to bless you generously. Amen. He wants to cause wealth and increase to come into your life. Oh, yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Nothing can stop that when you participate with God. Nothing except for doubt and unbelief and backsliding. I mean, you know. You can forfeit all that God would have done. Just with abandonment. Hear me. With abandonment. Live with abandonment. Happy face on your offering. That's great. Live with abandonment. You know, it's no problem to be a joyful giver when you know what you're going to get. When you know that he's a rewarder of those who do it the right way. Those who seek him. See, when we're giving, actually, maybe we've asked, Lord, do this, do that in terms of financial realm. When we're giving, we're pursuing. We're seeking. We're seeking. When we give, that's the application. It's like somebody saying, oh, I really want to have a revelation of the word. Well, did you read your Bible? That's pursuing. That's the seeking. And then laying a hold of it and a continuance of doing it until you possess it. It's you have it. That's the knocking. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The asking needs to have the pursuing, that needs the perseverance. Hallelujah. And you know, your children, give an offering to your children so that they can give. Teach them to give. I mean, it's like, look at your child, give them $10, say, look, you know, I'm giving this to you. And notice I'm giving it to you at offering time, but you can do with it what you want to do with it. Because depending on how little they are, you're going to give them some instruction. But you're still teaching them to do it. Are you going to put it in your pocket? And think about the candy bar that you're going to get with that. Or the whatever. Are you going to give it to the Lord? Well, if I give it to the Lord, then I'm not going to have what I was praying for $10. And if I give it to the Lord, it's like I'm giving away my answer to my prayer. No, no, give it to the Lord, and what he's going to do is he's going to multiply.
That's right.
He is? Are you sure, Dad? I'm sure. I promise you, he will. And then I don't need to go sneak 20 bucks underneath his pillow so that I can prove to him. Because God will do it. I just stand back and watch the Lord. Because the Father's going to take care of his own stuff. Do you understand me?
Yeah.
Somebody said, well, we just really financial straits. We'll give you a way out of it. Yeah. Just give. Just give it to the Lord. Watch what happens. Works for everybody I know that's tried it. And I promise you, you will not be an exception. I promise you that God cannot lie. I promise you that he will not tell you a fib. Hallelujah. And we really, at this juncture in time and what God's purpose to do through the ministry, we really need all of you to be multimillionaires quickly. Amen. So just come give. There you go. If anybody wants prayer for anything, sickness in your body, problems in your life, whatever, we're here to pray with you and for you. Hug a bunch of folks. Tell them that you love them before you leave. Hallelujah. Isn't God good? Isn't it wonderful? Can you feel the anointing in the giving? Can you feel the presence of the Lord? Can you feel that anointing? There's a miracle in the house. There's a miracle in the house. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name, I command you to be healed. What do you want?
I don't want to stop knocking. I don't want to ever stop knocking.
Well, that's good. Don't stop. Do not stop asking. Do not stop seeking. And do not stop knocking. Just don't stop. Just don't even let up. Do not even let up. Not for a second. To not even let up. Annalyn said, I don't want to stop knocking. Well, she doesn't want to stop asking and seeking either. It's a wonderful thing when you just find yourself all throughout the day asking. And you know the Father's going to do it. He's going to do it. What is it that you want? Okay, well, that's easy. That's really easy. Can I tell you the key? Happy. The key is Philippians 4:8. Philippians 4:8 will keep you happy. It really will. It's where we get involved in things that are opposite in any dimension of Philippians 4:8, which comes at us right, left, and center all throughout the day. People aren't aware of it. So right now, in Jesus' name, be strong. Holy Ghost is on the inside of you. Did you know that Holy Ghost is on the inside of you? Well, why don't you just let Him arise? I don't think He's afraid of anything. I don't think He's intimidated. I don't think that He's concerned or worried or has doubts. Or I believe He's pretty. What is it that you would like? What is it that you would like to have?
I answered it earlier, but I forgot what came back to
me. Okay. Sure. I'll lay hands on you. You just stand here and just think about it. Just put your hands towards heaven. See? And don't even think about it. You notice how you need it. Don't even think about it. Just let the Lord know that you love Him. What is it that you want?
Boldness.
Okay.
Increase of faith.
Okay. Okay. Father, we ask You now in Jesus' name for boldness, increase of faith. And a greater receptivity. So that's really what you mean. You know where all of those things that we would ask for, you know where they're found? They're found in us exchanging our life for His. The exchange took place, but we need to be reminded on a daily basis. Did you know that? The exchange took place. Jesus did it. But we need to be reminded on a daily basis. What is it that you want? I don't believe there's anything hindering your relationship with them. There may be things hindering you from receiving what you have need of. Are you understand? There's nothing hindering the relationship. He took care of that. Don't get me wrong. Don't understand. Don't misunderstand. I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for His namesake. You may not be able to do nothing in the kingdom. You may not be able to hardly receive anything, but the relationship is such that you're accepted in the beloved. You may not be able to do any more than a 1 or 2 year old, 3 year old child in the house. Little Justin over here. The relationship's just fine. Hey? He can't do anything in the house, really, but he's not supposed to. He's a little guy. His father wants just to grow. Nothing's entering the relationship in that sense. Just receive. You just receive in Jesus' name. You just don't allow anything else in your life except for what God said. You ask, you pursue it, and you don't let go. You don't let up. Bang till the door opens. Day you in. What is it that you want?
I just want Jesus. I want that to be more of Him.
Okay. So what does that look like? Do you understand what that looks like for you?
I believe so.
Okay. What it fundamentally looks like is that you don't get what you want. And that's kind of tough, ain't it? Yeah. No, it just if you can put practical application to it, because the Lord gives these things. You know, you say, well, I want more of Jesus and less of me. Fine. That means you don't get what you want. And you just got to be able to deal with that. then you know exactly what the terms of the agreement are. You know what you need to stop doing and what you need to start allowing. Somebody asked me one time, says, well, can you tell me in a different way? Not really. I mean, I can only tell it to you how it comes to me. That's the only way I can tell it, right? Is that the only way I can tell it? How it comes to me. And the Lord told me, take no thought for what I said. And so I do that. I trust Him. Take no thought for what I say. I just say it like it comes to me. And anything that is of me, I am persuaded that He will show me and teach me. Because He's promised. Thus, He will ultimately fulfill His promises. I can trust Him. I speak as an oracle of the Lord. I stand in this position, this place. I'm just going to say, well, I just don't believe God talk like that. But you know more than I do. He should be, you know, I hope He uses you more. You know what I mean? Did you figure it out yet? Okay, well, what do you want? Just give me one. One or two, huh? What? Well, in Jesus' name. Well, in Jesus' name. And Gina Monjasea, just give yourself to that then. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hallelujah. And you got to watch out, people. You can't take fire into your bosom and not be burned. You can't be, you know, allowing a lot of different influences, taking things in, watching things, seeing things, participating with things, it not have an effect on you. It's going to have an influence on you. I mean, it's hard for young men who aren't married. It's just hard. With all the lasciviousness and all of the immorality around them, man, just you're going to have to just cut yourself off from all the stuff, put blinders on. And be careful about what you allow. Just allow the anointing. Just don't watch crazy stuff on television and whatnot. Go to crazy movies. Because everything in advertisement is geared with the formula that is to draw men into lasciviousness, some kind of lust or covetousness. What is it that you want? In Jesus' name. Oh, Brittany of God, hear me in Jesus' name. Move forward. By the might and power of God. Do exploits. Do signs and wonders. Do not be limited in any way, because there is no limit. Do not be restrained or held back, for there is no restraint. Just believe God, stand faithful, and watch what He'll do. Whatever you've asked, He'll do it. Somebody said, Paul asked that the messenger of Satan would not be able to buffet him anymore. Well, you're not Paul, and I don't know that you have a messenger of Satan. That does not invalidate everything else that God's already said. Amen. Hallelujah. And then you have to think about all that Paul was able to do, signs, wonders, and miracles. And my goodness, talk about the word of knowledge. 2/3 of the New Testament, prophecy, doctrine. Everything Father's promised is yours. Everything's promised is yours. Everything that God has promised in the Bible is yours. It's available, and you can't live without it. What is it that you would like to have?
I want more of God. I want a freedom of God.
Okay.
In my life.
Okay. Father, I thank You for the anointing of the Holy Spirit, just the freedom of Your presence, that Your daughter will be able to feel and sense Your presence. Father, I thank You that there is an increase of faith here in this life, to know those things which You have promised and to lay hold upon them. now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, living God. Thank you for the flow of the heaven. Thank you for the flow of heaven. Thank you for the flow of the Holy Ghost. Zedomon, just put your hand on your belly right there. Sirenea, Sitanaya. Thank you, Jesus. Bokalain de Beresea. Ha. Freve veteste de candelo bosa panangla payan aneshe. In Jesus' name. All the blessings of heaven. All the wonderful blessings and provisions of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Photostaranangalish de perenete. Siporanambaleatea. Great boldness and confidence in the faith. Ha. Hallelujah. You know, you did good tonight. I watched you. And you know what? The Lord watched you, which is far more important. And because you're willing. I told a person one time, I just by the Spirit of the Lord, I told them, well, it's been more than once. I've told some people some pretty wild things that most people I don't think would do. And just their simple childlike faith and just confidence that it would happen and it would work. They went and did it. And every time, in those particular instances, every time the person's received healing, where I've given them something to do, go take and mix a little salt in your water. I told a person one time, take and mix a little salt in your water and drink it and you'll be made whole. Just come right out of me, just right by the Spirit of the Lord. I was confident in it. They were childlike in it. They just confident. They just did it like a little child, totally made whole. Every time it's been like that. And I watched Fatima tonight. She just wouldn't allow herself to cough. You know, she's like, I'm not going to have this. I tell you that the Lord honors that. Hallelujah. Father, I just thank you that this great witness that you're raising up right here, that there's just such a joy, such a manifest presence of your glory, such an anointing, that she's not hardly able to recognize herself, just so happy about all that you're doing. And people are going to look at her and go, is that the same lady? Is that lady that was kind of sad? Quite a bit? Yeah. Watch the abundance of God's divine provision come to you and flow out of you. Watch. I see it happening. I see every time I look at you now, I just see the anointing on you. What is it that you would like? You feel like you're getting sick? You're not sick. You're not sick. I say you're not sick. I say you're not sick. You're not sick. I tell you, you're not sick. Do not talk yourself into being sick. Hallelujah. Just let your hands towards heaven. Just the Lord wants to give you this fresh anointing over here. Fresh oil. Fresh oil. Fresh oil from heaven. Hallelujah. Fresh oil. The rub down by the Holy Ghost. The Lord says, when you fast, don't be as the hypocrite who disfigures his face, you know, puts makeup on, makes himself look a little bit more gaunt, like little charcoal under the eyes. No, that's what they did. Little charcoal under the eyes, make himself look like they're about to die. So everybody knows that they're fasting, okay? And that's what it means to disfigure your face. You see the word disfigure? It's literally to apply a facade. It says, but anoint yourself with oil. And in the culture of that period of time, if a person wasn't feeling good, feeling a little weary, a little worn out, maybe even sick, they had a culture of rubbing folks down with oil. They rub you down with oil. People still do that, right? Lord, come rub us down with some oil, Holy Ghost. Fresh oil. Come to me. Why'd you do it at the meeting? We got to rub down from heaven. Man, I tell you, I'm just so refreshed. So strengthened. How are you doing? You're doing good? You doing really good or just great?
Good. Really good.
Give me your hand. Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit that supplies all that we have a desire of. Every good, and you know what Father has for us? Every good and perfect gift. Isn't that beautiful? I mean, just to imagine that that's the kind of life that we're living. That's the abundant life. All things that pertain to life and godliness. Every good and perfect gift. Every spiritual blessing. With Father loves us so much that he says, whatever you desire, give it to you, just ask. So in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you're going to step into that realm. You're going to start living in that realm. And you're going to start enjoying the benefits. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Well, love you guys. Thanks for staying in church till like 11 o'clock at night. Knowing how to reach into faith to praise the name of the Lord Jesus. To be refreshed when you get up early in the morning. Make sure that you find a bunch of people, hug them, tell them that you love them. You want a greater amount of love and compassion flow through your life? Participate. There's one word for 2015. What is it?
Participate.
Participate.